It's the comic book show. It's the comic book show. It's the comic book show. Yeah.
Welcome back to Twin Galaxies Live, where every Wednesday at 9 p.m. PST, we do the comic book show. This is where we've gathered an all-star cast of comic book experts from around the web to bring you this week's comic book news, reviews, previews, and discussion. And on a very special night like this, also special guests.
Yeah. Boom!
Oh,
his
hello.
Beard!
It's like a 14-year-old boy's beard. It's like
that's a handsome, like, colonial Williamsburg.
I really hate that he says that that's a 14-year-old boy's beard when I've been growing this out at 35 for, like,
for 35 years.
No, it's been a while.
It's been a while.
Like, if you were Tom Hanks on that island in Castaway, like, this would just be you 4 years later.
I know.
Like, it's really depressing.
We're going to do a quick round of introductions, and we're going to save the very best for last. So until then, you can speculate who our mysterious special guest is. But let's start here. I am Jennifer Zhang, filmmaker behind The Evil Inside, also the producer and performer of the Batsuit music video. This is Mr. Matthew Hiscox. He is the director of Batman Death Wish, a viral YouTube Batman short film. Why am I using this cadence? I don't know. He also portrayed Superman in John Schneff's documentary, The Death of Superman Lives.
Yes,
what
did.
Happens? He also built that suit. He does comics-y stuff. And tonight he's cosplaying as somebody who might have worked on the Batman and Robin film crew.
As a gaffer.
From 1996 to 1997.
I'm so excited about this shirt. It's awesome.
Cosplaying as like a line
producer.
This?
Yeah, somebody gave this to me this week. I was like, oh, crap, that's amazing.
I saw it when it came in. I'm like, there's no way he's had this forever because he's like spazzy. He's like, well, I'm just like a sailing because it's cool. I'm cool.
Yep.
This is Mr. Wes Calimer, editor, actor, director.
I live
filmmaker.
In LA. I live in LA.
He dabbles. you may know him from his written works on Blast Off Comics, BoingBoing.com. Cutting Veggies is a film he made specifically for lesbians.
No, I didn't make it for lesbians.
No,
but
that's what I'm going with.
But they sure like it. They sure do like. They enjoy the cinema film that I made.
So they also play it at veterinarians' offices and just calms the animals
they do.
Down.
It's a very calming film about murder.
Are you comparing animals to lesbians?
I didn't make the
divisive
comparison.
Matt Hiscox.
They just play it at both locations.
To Jeff's, that's your clue. His name is Jeff.
What?
Jeff's left is Mr. Lucas Ackerman, head of the movement that is 1 million to save Wolverine and the X-Men. It's a long-running Facebook page that posts X-Men news on the daily and is gathering speed. Soon the show will come back on air.
I got some news, guys.
Okay.
I don't know if Marissa's in the chat, but Marissa, who you guys know is a big fan of Wolverine and the X-Men, she's a fan of the page and everything. She started something on a voice actor website to where she's going to cast people to read the scripts that we have from season 2 of Wolverine and the X-Men. So if you're a voice actor and you think your voice sounds like one of the X-Men, check it out. I just posted it on the site today, so...
Mm-hmm. You know what's weird? I'm pretty sure that what like her intro for you is going to be on your epitaph. Like it's going to be on your gravestone. And I really hope that because that, like they'll bring back like an episode.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm going to be cremated and I'm not going to have a headstone.
Oh,
so.
You know, you can be cremated and have a headstone.
Well, I'm not going to have
both
a headstone.
Bro.
I just said I'm not going to have a headstone.
And Ben Dunn, a face that we haven't seen here in a while and we've missed him dearly. He works for Ranker. He was one of the stars and creators of the Nerdist Nerd Turns. And currently you can catch him on Saving Throw, a web series about tabletop games.
And sometimes on Scared Sleepless.
And sometimes on Scared Sleepless.
And where can we find your beard, Ben?
I have no idea. I have yet to find it.
Yeah, me too.
And of course...
I see a little something.
Best for last, we have, please help us welcome Mr. Jeff Loveness, woo, writer for the Groot comics and also Jimmy Kimmel Live. Yeah, he's a big Hollywood type.
Whoa! Internet people, hello.
So, quick reminder before we grill him. No, just kidding, we're going to gently interview him. This show is really about you guys and the comments that you contribute to the show that's blown up on a super big screen right in front of us. We can't miss it. Like, for example, Vanilla Strike, who I've never seen here before, says, biology causes sexist and sexual comments. Very good, then.
Followed up with, that's probably one of the stupidest things I've ever heard.
Science. Yep.
I also like how biology is in air quotes. It's an abstract thing.
Biology.
I feel like we're missing a whole conversation that's happening.
And Kyle, it's Kyle's birthday today. Happy birthday, Kyle.
Yeah. Happy birthday, Kyle.
Welcome to being older.
Indeed. Yay. So, Jeff.
Yeah.
I think you're the first guest we've ever had here who's actually been a TV writer as well as a comics writer. Mm-hmm. Are the two similar? Worst question ever goes to Jennifer.
There's word documents involved and words of lines of dialogue and all
English.
That.
English.
Still use like letters and stuff.
Letters, yeah. Some emojis from time to time.
Oh,
as well.
That's professional.
It kind of like I'd say like when I was writing Spider-Man and stuff, it was like when I guess it's odd how they kind of correlate. When I first got the job at Kimmel, and I was writing like monologue jokes, I'm like, oh man, I don't know how to do this. I'm not like a stand-up. I didn't know how to do that. But in the back of my head, I'm like, oh wait, like I've been reading Spider-Man comics my whole life. Like, what would Peter Parker say in this situation? And like to get my feet on the ground as a late-night comedy writer, I would almost write it through the lens of like that kind of wisecracking Peter Parker sort of mentality. So yeah, they're kind of similar, I guess. They help me, like comics help me out and kind of get a grip on my job.
So you have like Peter Parker's filter,
yeah.
Comedic filter.
And then like years later, when I got the opportunity to write like Spider-Man comics, I'm like, oh, I've been doing this for years actually. So there we
Interesting.
Go.
Well, I mean, to tie the two together though, you write on Groot now, and I would imagine that the writing for Groot in the film and the writing for Groot in the book was probably sort of similar as far as dialogue.
Believe it or not,
might
it
have
was.
Been some connection.
Ish.
That was the Groot thing was at first like when I got offered the job, I was kind of hesitant at first because that's like you know six issues of you know I'm like oh man that could get kind of repetitive, but then I kind of saw it as a challenge, and I just went back and watched a lot of animated movies, like WALL-E or Studio Ghibli movies, even like old Charlie Chaplin silent films, to see how you can get humor and you know like character mode of an action with very sparse dialogue. And like, it's been really fun so far. And it was like a different skill set because like, yeah, like writing Spider-Man or even you know any character that can say more than three words. Yeah, like you kind of you're used to that, but like Groot was a. It's been a fun challenge so far, and it was like a nice stretch, I suppose.
Cool.
So hopefully you guys have been liking it.
So with Groot, you know, his language is very limited.
Yeah.
So you really have to rely on your artist to make certain expressions and everything to relay your story. Who's your artist on that?
Yeah, it's Brian Kessinger, who is this storyboard animator for Disney. He's down in Burbank, like that away. And he's great. Like, yeah, another, like, when I first took it on, I was really nervous. I didn't know who the artist was. I'm like, wow, I hope this works out. And I saw his layouts and the expressiveness he brings to Groot. It's just incredible. Mm-hmm. He's able to convey so much emotion based on, like, you know, a couple sentences that I write. So he's been wow. amazing. You guys should check him out. He draws lots of steampunk things on Instagram. So
there you go.
He's great.
Marissa Chastain says, you know, I think writing for Groot would be super hard. Hats off to you, sir.
Yeah.
Oh, thanks, guys. Yeah, no, it's been really hard. But I think so far we've got four issues out. Let me know what you think. It's been fun so far, and I think hopefully people have been responding well to it.
Nice. Now, we have a request here from our sound guy. He says, can you please move your mic pack from your belt to the ground?
Oh, sure.
There we go.
There we
okay. Nice.
We were actually
all
talking
right.
before the show about how, I don't know if you all had, like, if you're Redditors, but on r/comicbooks a couple days ago, someone posted was it from four?
Yeah,
was
number
it from
four.
Three?
Yeah,
it was from number four from Groot number four, which is just a splash page of this. What's her name?
I'm like a huge Marvel fan, and when I was in Groot and kind of getting the idea for the story, I really wanted to do this kind of cosmic road trip, and I'm like I used everything from like. I think that the weirdest mashup I had in the pitch was like Candide meets Pee-wee's Big Adventure. Like, I wanted to like have this giant kind of quest answering like, is the universe a good place to live or not? And like, 'cause the Marvel universe, like terrible things happen every single day. Like it would be a nightmare to live there. But then so many beautiful things happen as well. And I kind of had this, there's this old character called Numinous who was from like a 1980s Power Pack comic, but she has these awesome powers. She like represents, she's like this cosmic deity. She represents like fate and chance and like opportunity. Which like, oh, that's literally every single Marvel character's like origin story, like this freak accident or yeah. this opportunity or like, these, you know, that's like storytelling itself.
Yeah.
And so I kind of gave her a cameo grappling with whether she's made a good difference or not. It's kind of this abstract thing. But and then I had her talking to Groot about it. But so she lays out all the tragedy of the Marvel Universe on one page. So you have, like, you know, the Thing is horribly ravaged. There's the Dark Phoenix saga. Yeah, so, all these horrible things that kind of came from her, like, invisible hand. And she's cosmically depressed about it. But then on the following page, Groot rebuts, and she's telepathic, so she can. But then inside of the I Am Groot letters are all the beautiful things that have happened from the Marvel Universe. The Fantastic Four were brutally transformed, but out of that came this tightly knit family unit
and a really great Hollywood movie.
So many great reboots. Out of it came so much love, and you have these new generations of heroes, and so much selflessness that came out of it. And it was kind of this debate, and it was on Reddit comic books a day and a half at the top. So I was so happy to see that.
Yeah, it's such a beautiful. I'm sure we can find it somewhere. But
it's in beautiful number four, which we'll be talking about later on.
There we go.
Now, I don't know a whole lot about Marvel.
Yeah.
So this is pretty much Domino's mother, is what you're saying.
Yeah, basically. And on a much more Galactus scale, I suppose. Okay. But this character was only there for 2 issues of Power Pack. I had to kind of dig through the encyclopedia. Yeah. I was looking for random space characters.
Hasn't been used since?
I don't think so.
Interesting.
And it's just this weird, vague but also very interesting power. Yeah, it's like the mutant Domino, but on a big scale.
So she was a really depressing force, and Groot was a really empowering power.
Yeah, I just gave her this moment of crisis, because all the Secret Wars stuff going on, the universe is kind of imploding on itself, and I thought it'd be kind of a cool way to debate that abstractly.
Now, VDA Monster has the right idea here, guys. We're going to have lots of questions for Jeff, but really, we're also watching the chat to get your questions in as well. There we go. He says, does a Marvel writer get to pick the artist? Do you ever get a say in who you get teamed with?
I'm still at the phase, I think they're pairing us up. I think some, if you've got maybe bigger pull at Marvel, if you're a Brian Michael Bendis or something, I think you can kind of pick whoever you want to work with. I've been lucky. I've basically been attached to project, and then the editors kind of bring in artists. I've been lucky to work with a lot of new artists too. They brought in Luca Pizzari, who I think, what's he doing? Is it Death? There's some new, I should have looked it up. He did the Amazing Spider-Man special with me. Now he's doing a monthly. It's with a knight. Is it Death Knight?
Moon Knight?
Not Moon Knight. It's Medieval. He's got a sword. They're rebooting it for Marvel. I'll look it up later. Sorry.
Moon Knight is the other Kirby.
Yeah, no, it's not.
I thought we were playing a game. Knight!
But I've been lucky
Super Smash Brothers.
I think it works a couple ways, though. Because I'm kind of a newer writer, they'll team me up with a newer artist, but I've been really lucky. They've all been great, awesome. And it's cool. At the end of the day, there is nothing cooler than writing a script, and then a month later, you just see someone literally visualize that out of your words. It's the coolest thing.
Nice. So when you're writing a comic book script, how different is that from writing a screenplay?
They're actually pretty similar. I've been it's been a nice transition. I'd say screenplay writing, you can be a little looser with the action. You give specific action, but that the actor's going to make their choices, and you kind of know where it's living. Yeah. With comic book panel writing, I'd say it's you're writing storyboards almost.
Yeah, exactly.
You have to be very specific with what's happening. It can't really be that fluid of emotion, because it's got to be he punches that person. It's not so much every panel needs to have direct action.
Hmm. Do you get to write the kapows?
You can write the kapows, yeah. That's been part of the challenge, is coming up with interesting sound effect words, and how many Z's do you put in there? Mm-hmm. Or how many crackooms or
Crack-a-boom? Right, yeah, well, Crack-a-boom, would that be Marvel? Because Crack-a-boom is a DC, isn't it?
No, Crack-a-boom is...
What was the thing? What was the thing with Doomsday in DC? There was a giant Crack-a-boom, or in the 90s, Death of Superman. Anytime he appeared,
I think it was Crack-a-boom.
Was it Curse-wish? Says you're real.
Curse-wish!
That's the sound.
It was Crack-a-boom or...
Superman was killed with a giant Curse-wish.
I think that's a fun idea. I would love to write a comic. One of the reasons, just because I would make up a sound, and I would have so much happiness knowing that people would try and sound it out. They're gonna try and say it.
I would love to be that dick editor who just goes and crosses one of the Z's off of
this is unacceptable.
No.
Too many.
Or the person who created Mr. Mizzleplex?
Yes.
Come on.
Speaking of unacceptable, we have Asteroid Man, who's joining us on Skype. You can see his video. He is the lower right.
Hey.
He's waving right now. But Asteroid he asks, has there ever been something that Marvel has said, no, you can't do that? And if so, what was it?
Yeah, let me think.
You can talk about the Superman thing.
The Superman thing. Okay, well, they eventually let me do this, but they're in Groot number one, since it's like a road trip across the universe kind of thing, I wanted to pack in a lot of tropes from different things. And I don't know where I got the idea, but I'm like, oh, wow, like, he should, like, as they're trying to get different rides across the universe, there's, like, a moped that kind of evokes Dumb and Dumber. I'm like, what's, like, a famous, like, space craft and, like, a planet? Oh, my God, he should steal Superman's ship. Like, and so we have this scene that's very evocative of, like, the first, like, Superman the movie. And there's, like, a Marlon Brando type, like, putting his son into a rocket ship on, like, a planet that's about to explode. It is, like, straight up the Superman origin. Yep. But right before they do it, like, Groot and Rocket steal the ship and take off. And so they just strand this baby on the planet.
Oh, no.
And so, like, they fit in that tiny little ship.
You know, it's Kryptonian technology.
I guess,
you know,
that's true. Can,
but it was, like, you know, clearly a parody, but at the same time, like, you know, it's not hard to tell what that was.
Yeah.
We had to fight for it, but and for a while it wasn't going to happen, but my editor was nice enough to kind of fight for it. And I had to rewrite that scene like 8 times because you want to give him like a very close Jor-El, like Marlon Brando, Russell Crowe, like Farewell My Son sort of thing, but it couldn't be too close to either the movies or the cartoon, so it's like this, it lives in the middle.
Just general
enough. Yeah. And maybe, like you said, with the editor like taking letters off, the most specific note I ever gotten, I had to take off like the hyphen between Jor and L. Like, I had to take out that piece of punctuation because it's too close to the Superman mythos. Wow. I replaced it with, like, a slash.
Okay. So. We had Cod Thor Shots had a question. How long does it take to make a comic from start to finish? He was saying, so when you start working on it to when it hits shelves, like, a general idea?
Let me think. I think I got the Groot job in, like, January. You kind of flesh it out, you get your outline done. I think the first script I turned in was like mid-February, and it hit shelves, I think June? So it was like three, I'd say, but there was like a period of gathering it together. It was like the first book, and kind of it took a while. Generally 3 to 4 months before it hits the shelves, I guess.
Okay.
Have you ever met your artist in real life?
Yeah, he lives in Burbank. We just got like celebratory beers and hot dogs like last week, because the script was all done.
Cool.
How long does it take you to write a script from beginning to end?
I'm very lazy, so it's like hard to... I usually just go up until the last day. They usually get... I mean, if it's a monthly book, you usually have a month to turn it around, maybe 3 weeks, 2 weeks. Sometimes Groot would go very quickly, because if you're just writing action, obviously there's sparse dialogue.
Yeah.
Sometimes it flows, but then sometimes it's very hard to think how to like lock the story in. And it took longer than, say, like Spider-Man, because... Yeah. If you're Spider-Man, you can kind of fill up like a page and a half with just banter and doing flips.
Yeah.
That's like 80% of a Spider-Man comic is bantering, being sad, and like flipping over the rhino.
I love that that's your tutorial. Like, hey, aspiring Spider-Man writers, flipping and witty banter.
You gotta be sad, gotta flip, and gotta banter.
We have to thwip, too.
Yeah, gotta thwip.
You gotta thwip. You gotta quip, obviously. You gotta flip, you gotta thwip.
Right.
You gotta quip, you gotta thwip, you gotta flip.
I feel like one of you are like having a stroke.
I think we're both having a stroke. We're having a shared stroke.
It doesn't matter. Call 911 right now.
Yeah, it's okay though, because it seems like we're having some minor technical difficulties.
Oh.
So hopefully we'll be back up very
soon.
What's
happening?
But if you are joining us and you can still hear us, if you go to twingalaxieslive.com, the stream should still be up. It looks like the stream might be having issues on Twitch.
Wait, so let's stand by here. Can we get Doc or Neo to see if our TG live stream is up and our Twitch stream?
Doing stuff.
Okay, I guess we're back.
I feel like Overstocked apparently was posting links. Probably was posting links to Overstock.com. Overstock.com! Sponsor!
No, it says it's still working on TG Live.
My mom loves that website. She does.
Yeah?
She really does.
Well, as we mentioned before, you're not just a comic book writer. You write for Jimmy Kimmel.
Right, yeah.
Tell us about that experience. Like,
that's been great. I've been there about 4 years, four and a half years. And I got the job. It's kind of a long story, I guess. But basically, I used to make YouTube sketches just with my friends and stuff. And the one that got seen, I did like a parody of Spider-Man, basically. And it got like a couple. It kind of did well on the internet. Mm-hmm. It was like 5 years ago. It was called Wes Anderson Spider-Man. And it was like... There's a ton of Wes Anderson parodies nowadays, so I feel like it's been diluted, but I thought it was original at the time. But it was like, what if Wes Anderson made like those Tobey Maguire era Spider-Man movies? And that they kind of saw my work through that, and I was freelancing for The Onion for a little bit, and then they got Kimmel phoned. It's fun. It's a lot of work. Like those, I mean, those shows are every single day.
Yeah.
And it, like you
turnaround's crazy.
Turnaround is
especially
crazy.
Especially with you writing a book as well. Like that's how do you?
I don't really
separate that in your brain.
I don't really socialize at all, or like go outside.
I don't have a life.
Is this your first time outside?
This is my first time outside. Yeah. Okay.
This is the world.
Unfortunately, yes. It's nighttime, so you still haven't been exposed to the sun.
No, no, no. No. I hear it's nice.
It's not now.
We call it the day star.
Yeah, it's a fun show. Like it's just really cool to, you can wake up and you know that like it is the same more or less job, but there is something new every day, and you get to have some sort of commentary on the world, and yeah, it's fun.
Do you go into the studio every day?
Yeah, every day, basically. From like 7 to 6. They're low now.
Well, as we're enjoying Jeff's interview, that's the word.
Yeah.
I just wanted to make sure that we are activating the Moobot. That'll get his social media. It's already up. Cool. Can we pump up the frequency? Okay. So every 5 minutes, you're going to be able to see a Moobot that links you through to all of Jeff's social media. Make sure you give him a follow and a like and whatever it is that kids do these days. I believe we also have
clips.
We have video clips. We have the aforementioned Wes Anderson Spider-Man video if you would like for us to show it.
Oh, yeah.
We actually just had someone in the chat who wanted to watch it, okay. So that might be a good time to
Oh, yeah,
play
go
it.
Ahead.
Let's do it.
Cool.
They can still hear us, so you can commentate.
Oh, okay.
Over it if you'd like.
It's like your commentary now.
Sure. Yeah.
Enjoy it.
Your audio?
I don't know. Can they hear us? Can we mute it between now?
They can hear us.
Oh, cool.
Can hear,
okay. Yeah. We can't. Okay, yeah. We can't. Okay.
But you've seen this.
I have seen this before.
So
yeah.
You're fine.
No, I'm stronger.
This was made in like 2010. I was a student at Pepperdine, and my friend,
heard your uncle
like, just
that's
shot
horrible.
This over a weekend.
You gotta keep your head up high, though.
$30.
Amazing for
yes.
I don't think I ever did, but they
can't.
Is that a thing?
I have heard.
Is that like a tradition or something?
So what are you going to do now?
So you just drive by the hill and you're like, I want to run.
I'm going to go on an overnight drunk and in 10 days I'm going to set out to find the thug who shot my
got it.
That costume, my roommate at the time was a child's entertainer at a birthday party, and he basically like stole this so he could use it.
That's excellent.
So that is like covered in just the sweat of a thousand entertainers.
It's great. I used to have that suit.
Oh, it's going great.
I used to have that suit.
I love you.
Not that suit, but that suit.
I know.
And I, as I had never smoked a cigarette before, and we did this take like 11 times, and so
like you're not doing it right.
Yeah. A, I wasn't doing it right. But the next day, I like seriously craved a cigarette. I basically became addicted. Yeah.
You're like, nope.
Cigarettes are not good, guys. Don't do it.
No, please don't.
Don't do stuff.
But that was
just read comics.
That like kind of like went around the internet and stuff. And it was just like my first exposure to making YouTube videos on that kind of scale. And as you could see, it's like very low production value and like a lot of friends making
stuff.
No, it looks
great.
But it was
still better than views.
Yeah,
still better than Spider-Man 3.
It was just a fun. It was a really fun thing to make with my friends.
Nice.
And it got you a job.
And it basically
got
me
a
job.
And we have a clip for that job too. Do we want to show that now?
Or we could get in a few questions.
Oh, yeah.
Run Quickly Fool said, seriously though, as a writer for a comic, it's difficult to coming up with more original ideas for a story or a plot. What's your process?
Yeah, that is, I mean, that's a very valid thing. Like, especially say like Spider-Man, when you get that, I'm like, wow, like he's flipped over a lot of people.
Yes.
He's
been sad a lot.
Flipped, he's been sad a lot.
It's like,
times. What do you do? I guess you just have to almost put your, like, there's been 1,000 Spider-Man stories told, but you haven't told one before. So what's the most unique approach you can bring to it?
And to me, perspective.
Yeah, and like for me with Spider-Man, there's a lot of different ways that, you know, writers treat Spider-Man. For me, like, I always gravitated to that kind of mess, like Spider-Man 2 version of him, the Tobey Maguire version. And I just wanted to kind of write it from that perspective. It's like and I remember I was like 8 pages into the script and it felt kind of generic. I'm like, oh, I've kind of seen this before. It feels like ordinary Spider-Man. And I forgot, like, I left out, like, the loser Peter Parker stuff. And I went back and put my own sort of, like, he just, like, didn't have the courage to approach a girl in a Chipotle, basically. And I'm like, oh, this feels better. Like, this feels like the Spider-Man that I enjoy. And, like, and then that made the rest of the issue, like, flow so much better. And, like, you just, I guess, you try to find it is daunting to think, like, yeah, like, so many people have told these stories, but that's because the characters are so accessible and so many perspectives can flow through them, so just kind of put your own in there.
There's different ways you can go with the
Absolutely,
character.
Yeah.
Like, infinite amount yeah. of ways.
The whole Chipotle thing, that just flashed. I'm like, I read that book. And it was, I remember that scene vividly. That was so good. So congratulations. That was so fantastic.
You
made an
life.
Impression.
Yeah.
Well, awesome. I actually believe your books have been featured on the show before.
Yeah, I reviewed that book.
I believe
and
we wow. presented.
And we won because of that scene. Oh, yeah. I kept talking about that scene.
Thank you so much, man. Yeah. That was, I loved, writing Spider-Man, like I said, with the Kimmel stuff. Like, he's been, and even with that Wes Anderson, and like, he's just been a part of my life for so long. And so when I finally got the chance to actually, you know, write in his voice, it was this very, like, overwhelming feeling.
Sure.
And I'm glad you liked it, because that meant awesome. A lot to me, that whole run.
Why at Chipotle?
It was like, well, it wasn't Chipotle so much in, like, it was like,
It was a Starbucks, wasn't it?
It was like a Starbucks, but he was also ordering a breakfast burrito. Yeah. I kept it vague as, like, brand stuff, you know. But he was just ordering, like, a breakfast burrito, and he saw someone, but he didn't want to be weird, and he just, you know, didn't do anything, and just felt like a loser. And then the next scene is him just, like, eating a breakfast burrito on top of a building.
Awesome.
Good. Now,
he left the burrito.
And he left the burrito, yeah. The tragedy. Yeah.
You're already writing for some amazing just creative works in general. Groot, it sounds like you wrote Spider-Man, you work on Jimmy Kimmel. Is there a holy grail for you? A book that you aspire to write on?
Yeah, you know, I think...
you can talk about X-Men.
Yeah, on the Marvel... I was talking to them before the show. I think, like, I would love to do, like, a kind of a recurring Spider-Man thing, because I really... was happy with, I think, how it got that voice down, and I really enjoy that character. It's on a personal level. But I think, yeah, the Holy Grail, I would love to do, like, an X-Men team book. That's just, like, that's the best thing in the world. Like, maybe, like, on the level of, like, an Astonishing X-Men or an Amazing X-Men, like, kind of a smaller group, but you just pick your core members and have a lot of fun and explore some cool stuff and, you know, have Cyclops be sad and, like, fire something into the air.
Jane!
Yeah. It's an Easter egg, if you go and look at my things, I realized in, like, three out of, like, my last three comics, there's always a moment of Cyclops, like, looking really sad and, like, blasting into the air. So it's that's, like, a recurring trope with my comics.
That's your thing. That's your Christmas time Shane Black.
I love it. I love a depressed Cyclops moment.
It's the best moment.
What about Deadpool?
You know, this, I think, is going to make me... This is my unpopular opinion. I'm not crazy about Deadpool. I like the Jerry Duggan stuff. I think he's an awesome writer. There's something... And maybe I need to be educated more, because I haven't read a ton of Deadpool, but at his worst, sometimes it comes off like the eighth grader who's really loud in class.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I don't like that person in real life. I don't want to...
Well, but, I hate eighth graders.
Right. But I also, I fully acknowledge, like, maybe I haven't read enough of him or gotten, like, a full...
I mean, honestly, the reason I ask is because Deadpool, I think at his best, Deadpool is basically Spider-Man without the angst.
Right, right.
So it's like, you're basically getting the quippy Spider-Man 100% of the time.
Deadpool's like
with guns.
That's R-rated.
Yeah, exactly. He's not allowed. Like, Spider-Man's not allowed to go certain places because he's Spider-Man, because he has this, like, huge mythos, and, like, there's a big, like, he has the whole great responsibility power thing.
Right. No, I think.
Whereas Deadpool's just like, fuck it. Like,
I think that's a fair point. You can break the fourth wall. You can have, like, really kind of harder
rules,
things like that. Yeah. But at the same time, like, I like Spider-Man more because of that angst. Like,
right. He anchors him.
Yeah, he's like a Woody Allen character stuck in this, just doing his best.
Yeah.
Well, we've got some more good questions coming in from the chat. The first one is VDA Monster, who finally managed to update his stream, so he's back with us again.
Oh, good.
And his first question coming back was, Jeff, what do you think of the X-Men Bishop?
Oh, yeah, I like Bishop. I think, where's he at in the comics now? He, like, went bad for a while, and he got, like, sent off.
He came back during X-Force, Uncanny X-Force, and then he had some sort of fire bear with him for a while.
Yeah, as one does.
But then he makes up with Hope towards the end of the run, and then ever since then I haven't seen him since.
I liked him a lot. So. I hadn't read that run. I liked that turn they gave him in, like, that Messiah War thing where he became, like, this very desperate, not even like a villain, like, he was trying to prevent
save
his future from happening.
Save his world.
I think it's a cool power. He hasn't really been utilized in a big way in a while. Mm-hmm. It's a great power.
Yeah.
I'd be down for that. I don't know his character that well, though, as far as, like, his mannerisms. He just always seemed like a very intense dude from the future. Yeah. I guess from, like, the 90s cartoon. Mm-hmm. Like, He just kept screaming like for the future and tried to kill Gambit a lot. That's all I remember.
For the future.
Asteroid Man says question for the guestion. Oh. All right, you win for
clever
weirdest rhyme of the day. Do you think Vin Diesel looks like Groot? That's a weird question.
He's got space tree features, I suppose.
He does. You should say that on your Twitter.
Features. Yeah,
and then tag him.
Getting a flame war with Vin Diesel.
See what happens.
Sorry. I was just going to say, you're hilarious on your Twitter. That's the whole reason why I started following you. Like, people started retweeting your stuff in my feed, and I was like, this guy's hilarious. He deserves a follow.
Oh, thanks, man. I appreciate that.
Yeah. In real life, too.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually want to rephrase that question, because as a writer, I would imagine that you have a fairly specific voice for Groot in your head.
Yeah.
Is the interior voice of Groot, does it line up with Vin Diesel, or do you imagine
talk about
Groot
fast cars a lot?
Right, he talks
and
so much
family.
About fast cars.
He's a big fan of family.
Loves family.
Loves family.
He doesn't have friends, he's family.
He's all family.
Yeah, that's a good question. I think the Rocket voice is pretty, and when I'm writing Rocket, he's in the book a lot too. He's pretty close to Bradley Cooper. I think he nailed that almost like that weird, like almost Philadelphia accent.
Yeah, yeah.
What's going on?
Yeah.
Groot, it's close, but maybe it's a little warmer. I think I tried to make, I love the optimism and like there's this like purity to Groot. It's like a very nice golden retriever. But I also wanted to have in the comic, especially like issue 2 primarily, like there is, when I took the project, I kind of looked into the character, and I actually think there's a lot of loneliness there in the way of, like, not to get too deep, but, like, say, like, my aunt had a kind of a bad stroke, like, years ago, and she can't talk very well, but she's incredibly smart. Like, she was a reporter back in the day, like, for, you know, local news. Used to be a very good communicator, but now she can't do that, and you can see, like, the frustration that she has.
Yeah.
And I realized, like, oh, my God, like, that. There's something of that in Groot. Like, if he lost his translator, which he does in the second issue, Rocket's not there. We kind of embodied him with this sort of frustration of like no one understands me.
Can I communicate?
They think and like they see this monster when he's actually, you know, like the kindest person in the Marvel universe.
Yeah.
But they just see this rampaging monster. And there's some and that had not really, as far as I know, been explored in a great, you know, deal. Because he's usually kind of like a one note kind of joke character, right? Or like he'll do something shockingly violent. But, like, I wanted to really explore the frustration and, like, maybe, like, the pain. And you show, like, he probably had years before he met Rocket where he was just this, like, you know, monster to other people. And and that's something we kind of tried to...
Like aphasia patients.
Yeah.
Oh.
And I really enjoyed, I think people, hopefully people liked Groot 2. It showed, like, how they met, basically. Because even in the comics, like, they kind of met during like the Annihilation Wave, but they already kind of knew each other. Like, they're introduced in as like a group, much like in the movie.
Yeah.
But when you think about it, like how does a raccoon and a giant tree meet, and how do they become friends? And
well,
so that was
Rocket
really
probably climbed up it, and Groot's like, "I am Groot."
That's it. Yeah.
But, like, trying to steal his nuts.
It was fun showing that connection kind of grow over time. I had them like trapped in a Kree prison somewhere and kind of grow from there.
That's awesome.
It's too bad. We were about to showcase one of the coolest features of our show. Asteroid Man actually pulled up a Photoshop version of Vin Diesel as Groot with a Groot face.
Please.
It was there for half a second, but unfortunately it looks like we're down for it. So maybe we'll get... Oh, wait.
Show us that horrific...
There
that's
we go.
Oh. That is terrifying.
That is very unsettling.
No.
Wait, who is that as Groot?
That's Vin Diesel as Groot.
You know what he kind of looks like? He looks like Michael J. Fox in Teen Wolf, but like really messed up
a little bit, yeah.
Tree version.
Like
of
they
him.
Forgot Barkier. To put the hair on him.
Yes.
Never show us that again.
Never again.
Never show us that again.
It's not as terrifying as the shirts that we have.
Yeah.
Actually,
one of our fans.
Asteroid Man is the man who made those shirts.
Show him the Bradley Cooper.
He wore it last week.
Rocket
I don't
raccoon
know if
image.
It might be in laundry or.
He made us shirts. That has Rocket Raccoon with Bradley Cooper's face, and it's one of the most like terrifying.
It's a living nightmare.
It was the very first movie Rocket Raccoon.
He sells it. You could buy it on like Redbubble.
That's the great thing. He doesn't sell it. He gave away the image for free.
Right.
You just pay the cost to have the shirt printed.
So
he doesn't make any money on it. He legitimately just wanted to share it. We all got them printed up. They're ridiculous.
That's cool.
He wore it last week for the show.
I love that he's legitimately like casing his entire place.
Where is it?
Oh, it's terrifying.
Oh,
That's that's look at terrifying. God. Look at it.
That's horrifying.
He like peers into your soul.
That is the first picture of Bradley Cooper as Rocket.
It was, yeah. Before the movie came out, we're like, we have the first look.
He like did it during one of those shows.
Yeah.
Yeah, by the end of the show, it was ready.
I think the worst part about that, besides like the dead eyes, is just like the slight smirk that he looks so at you longingly. It's so weird.
It's the face that, you know, his victim sees.
Before the life leaves him.
Yeah. He just made the Vin Diesel one now, so now there's matching shirt.
Thank you for that.
Oh, no.
I literally just made it.
We have a front and back version.
Dripping blood.
Oh, my God.
Yes. On the other.
We have to do that. We have to have Vin on the back.
Or side by side.
Or side by side.
Or on both shoulders.
I feel like the women are really going to like this.
Yes. You're going to have to fight them off with a stick.
Jennifer, as a female, if you saw
a guy
a
wearing that in a Chipotle,
you'd be like, on it.
You'd want him to talk to you.
Yeah, absolutely.
You wouldn't run away at all.
Well, we've talked a lot about some of your past projects. Right now, you're still working on Groot. I think you probably have one more issue to write. I would imagine that you've already finished issue five, and you're working on issue six.
I'm just after I leave tonight, I got to put the final like lettering pass on book five. Like, it's really cool. Like the phases of comic book writing. You get obviously the pitch, outline, script, then the art comes in. Then there's like the coloring phase. Then there's a specific letterer that comes in and just does the letters. Mm-hmm. And then you come in and do like a dialogue pass to make sure all the bubbles fit with the art. I'm really just amazed with the artistry and all the levels of sophistication that go into it. Just finishing up five right now, like a letter pass. I finished the script for six, but we still have to do like all the art and stuff. But hopefully you guys will like it. I just got some pages today that I'm very excited about.
I have a lot of friends that like they're writers, and they love, like you said, like they love getting the art for their work. But have you ever experienced like getting the art back and it not at all being what you wanted? But you're like, but it's you did all this work. Yeah. I don't want to be a dick.
I've been really lucky. Like the guys are all really good. I've never had like a huge problem.
Okay.
Every once in a while, like I think it's like part of the creative process. You have it in your head, like it's gonna look some way. And then maybe it's different, but it's like, well, the artist is just as much of a creator on this as I am. Like, this is, you know, you kind of give them the autonomy there. There's only been, like, once or twice where I've had, like, a note, like, oh, I think maybe we redo this one. Like, there was, like, I think, I don't think he would mind. Like, there's, like...
Call him out.
Call him out.
You fucked
and,
up.
In the Inhuman Era special, which is, like, Amazing Spider-Man, the Inhumans, and all-new Captain America... There's this kind of big fight at the end when, like, Sam Wilson finally, like, owns it. It's like, oh, yeah, I'm Captain America. I got to be Captain America. And there's, like, a big panel where I wrote where he finally... It's, like, this aerial battle with this, like, wind creature. And it's, like, this giant sort of, like, you know, bird versus bird person fight.
Okay.
And there's just a panel where he just finally, like, smacks him with the shield all the way down to the ground. And I think he... I don't know if he got it wrong, but he, like, it was, like, a light kick. And I'm like, oh, that's not...
A light kick.
Like a sauntered kick.
It was, like, yeah, it was, like, a swoop kick. And I'm like, it's good, but, like, I think we need, like, he's Captain America. Like, you got to have, like, the, yeah. You got to have just,
did
like,
he have
the big...
have sandals on? It's just, like, no. It's
loose
down.
Loose Crocs.
They were lime green.
I think that was the only time when we had to, like, redo it. And it was great. And, like, the guy, Alec Morgan, like... I love the art. The way he draws Spider-Man, he draws him with such like a lanky posture, and like I don't really like an overly muscular Spider-Man. I like him, it's like maybe
scrawny.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah.
Lean.
I like him lean and like always like hanging off of something or something. And Alec and Luca as well, like they just gave him the perfect posture on there.
Cool.
Beautiful. We have some weird questions, but we are gonna start moving out of the interview phase. But that doesn't mean that you guys can need to stop with questions.
Keep
we're gonna bring them in throughout the entire show. For
where do your parents live?
What blood type are you?
What have you done?
How much do you weigh? We love Marissa, but the questions she's been asking in conjunction here, like, first she told you that she liked your facial hair, like, twice.
Thank you. That's
and
very nice.
And then now she's asking how much do you weigh and where do your parents live. So,
what's your social security number?
Yeah,
Asteroid wants to know, who's your daddy and what does he do?
Who's your daddy and what
I wish
do?
I knew, damn you.
This is the one thing he told us not to talk about and you made us talk about it.
Oh, that also answers the where do your parents live question.
Oh, no.
Oh, he doesn't know.
Awkward.
All right, guys. Well, why don't we segue out of this by playing that clip from Jimmy Kimmel Live that we have. When we come back, we're going to move into the Daily Planet, and also we're going to continue asking Jeff questions, asking him your questions. So keep them coming, guys. What are we about to see here?
This is a famous one, right? This is like all around the internet.
Yeah. This was a sketch. This sketch that I wrote at Jimmy Kimmel, and I have a brief cameo in it. But this is maybe like, as far as for you guys and whatnot, and me, like this may be my favorite sketch that I've written there so far.
Yeah, dude. Oh, cool.
With a familiar face.
Yeah.
Take a look, see.
You can talk again if you want to.
Oh, okay.
Commentate.
You son of a bitch.
I don't mean to move on to other parts of your career, but there's a Star Wars movie coming out. J.J. Abrams is directing it.
Yeah, so did you write the whole books?
And I would love to know what your plans are for this.
You know, I can't.
You can't say what's
did
going
you
on.
Have like a rehearsal time with?
He did not rehearse. You know, there's nothing. The first time he's doing it.
I can't talk.
Right. Well, we have some people in the audience like to ask you some questions. Would you be all right taking some questions from the audience? Any rules?
Now look closely for a lengthy
no Star Wars question. Okay. All right. Yeah. No problem. I think we have. Okay. Yeah. We have a gentleman right there.
Aha.
No Star Wars questions.
No Star Wars questions.
Do you like being in movies?
That wasn't acting. I was just that nervous.
Okay, so pretty straightforward there. Do we have any? Do we have another? Okay, we have someone right over here.
Yeah. This is great.
Are you hungry?
Are you hungry?
No, not really.
We have
thank you.
Okay, thank you. And it's we have an okay, yes, is it right here. Right. Question right there. Yeah. Yeah, somebody
You son of a bitch.
What do you want?
Yeah, you'd like that, wouldn't you?
Always trying to blame me. You're the one who couldn't keep it in your furry pants.
Actually, he's not wearing any kind of, doesn't wear pants.
I risk my case. You're so full of how did he get in here? Did you set this up? Did you set this up, Kimmel?
No. I just thought you two could bury the hatchet. I mean, I know you've had issues in the past, and I thought it'd be nice to get you together, you know? What happened between you?
He knows what he did. She was my wife. You Wookiee sack of
Please, that's not...
You listen to me. You're either on my side, or you're on his side.
Well,
no, I'm out of here.
No.
Really.
No, I really didn't
and
mean
you,
to.
I'll see you in hell.
That means there won't be a. Well, 42 is in theaters now. Harrison Ford, everyone. We'll be right back with Anthony Mackie.
I think you can basically die now.
Great promotion for 42.
Yeah, great 42.
Absolutely.
I think the question we all have is, where was your inspiration for Wookiee Sack of Shit?
Yes.
I'm very glad you brought that up. I was going to say, Harrison Ford had two notes on the script, and it is my favorite. I wish I had the handwritten copy, because I think I lost it. Like, his assistant, like, or his like agent, or whoever, like, came out of the dressing room, and like, actually, Harrison loved it. He just has a quick note. I look at the piece of paper, and there was just a line. Originally, it was Wookiee piece of shit. I'm like, yeah, okay, fine.
Whatever.
I just look, there's a pencil mark, scratched off, and just written above it says sack.
That's so like,
much better. Thank you, Harrison Ford.
You know what's fascinating about that clip? Because you're a legit writer, you write stories. You can tell that there's so much like backstory.
Right.
But then Harrison Ford's like legitimate frustration. I feel like he's experienced as Harrison Ford for plus 40 years. He's like, this is my chance.
Yeah.
So like when he gave you that note, he's like, oh no, he's a sack of shit.
Yeah, and like, there's actually a sketch we did before that, like a year and a half before. It's much smaller. It didn't go as like viral, but it's. Basically, like, it's the same thing. He's like, if you look it up on YouTube, like, I think it's Harrison Ford settles a feud or something. He's in his green room, and it's basically the same thing. Like, Chewbacca comes to talk to him. He's like, oh, get the hell out of here. She's my wife. And that's the second time we did it. And I'm hoping for episode 7, if he comes on the circuit, I want to, like, bury the hatchet. And have, like, yeah, I want to, this is my Star Wars trilogy. And I want to finish it.
That's so good.
But that was a really fun day, and I will always remember that line. The line chain sack of shit.
That's amazing. Well, guys, look, you're getting some applause from Run Quickly Fool, and I as well had seen that like many times before. I had no idea you were the one that wrote that. That's amazing. Now I'm nervous.
Oh no.
We're in the presence of celebrities.
No.
He knows what he did.
She's not used to being around talent.
Around people
because she knows us.
We're going to move into our first segment, and Jeff is going to be doing us the honor of being one of our reporters here. I need to stop using Lois Lane as my go-to reporter. He's going to be one of our Lois Lanes.
No, I would gladly. Lois Lane is my favorite DC character. I will gladly go with Lois Lane.
Really?
Oh, she's great.
You don't like DC.
Right.
That's
right.
Interesting.
He doesn't. Lois Lane is his favorite character.
That's actually
a fascinating thing to say.
Messed up, Ben.
That was Terry Hatcher.
Ben's a sexist.
He's
sexist.
He wants to burn all women's mouths shut.
Now that's you, Lucas. Moving on.
Wow.
First segment of the night is, as always,
it's the Daily Planet.
Things are happening.
It's where we fill you in on all of the news that's happened revolving around your favorite superhero characters from this past week.
All right.
I will start us off because I'm very excited for this one.
All right, then.
Guys, so we told you all about how Battle Chasers is coming back. Well, Joe Madureira and Airship Syndicate has gone to Kickstarter. They just started their Kickstarter yesterday to bring Battle Chasers back as a video game called Battle Chasers Night War. It's already reached 80% of its goal, and they're already giving us more rewards as it comes. Like, they're opening up to console now as well. But some of the other rewards that you can get for donating and funding this project is T-shirts, art books, copies of past Battle Chasers issues, copies of future Battle Chasers comics, and a whole lot more. And here is a clip of some gameplay.
Okay.
Wouldn't Battleship have been so much better?
No. I meant Battle Chasers.
Battleship is great.
No, it's horrible. This is like a JRPG game. I guess it's like Final Fantasy.
Yeah.
Where they wait to hit something.
Yeah.
That's always irritating.
It's a people fight.
It's this giant monster like, oh, that's my turn. Ooh. But I'm gonna hop. That's all they do.
Don't worry, Rihanna's gonna have her cameo.
Thank goodness.
I feel like Drake is about to start rapping.
Yeah, that's right. RPG.
It's actually Liam Neeson. He's got a very particular set of skills.
Yes, he does. Oh,
how like when they put the speech bubbles in these games and it's just dot, 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 like, but it takes up the whole screen just for an ellipses.
Because Link can't buy gauntlets?
Can he?
Link doesn't buy things. He just finds things in people's pockets.
Wait, found him.
Link is very poor.
He's very poor. And
he goes into people's houses and breaks their shit.
Oh my God.
He's just a violent little boy.
Yeah.
Okay.
You can cut it.
Do you read this one right here?
Oh, 92?
Yeah.
Got it. Oh, great.
Wait. No.
Well, let's just go in order. Let's not mix it up.
Yeah, it's fine.
Well, I already told him that he's going to be reading this one.
Whatever.
So he's probably really prepared
for
it.
Whatever you want to do.
But guys, I'm really excited for this game. the more comics are coming. And the goal was $500,000, and they're already past 400,000. So, and it's only been a day and a half.
That's interesting. Like, knowing how much it takes to develop a game, $500,000 is a deal.
Wow. Yeah, they're not going to be making much money off of that. They're, I mean, obviously, they're going to go way past half a mil. Yeah. They're going to go way past their stuff.
Yeah.
It's pretty.
What I'm curious about is, I mean, this is a property that's been gone for so long. Do you think it's a wise idea to launch it as a video game before bringing the comic back, or would you?
I mean, look at how much money they've made in a day and a half. I think it's a really good idea.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But see, they're going to have
more comics, and they're going to have.
Yeah. No, and don't get me wrong. I like the old Battle Chaser series, but I think it would have. I mean, it seems like a lot of people are shocked that this is even going to be a thing, and they're like, "Oh, the tiers are already sold out." I would think that it maybe would have been a better marketing strategy to release the first issue and say, our Kickstarter is going live on, and then have a bigger goal.
I don't think so, just because they're... Because all of these Kickstarters, the reason they do so well is because it's all nostalgia-based, right? Hmm. So, like, I don't know if you guys remember when Jane... Oh, God, what's her name? She did the Gabriel Knight series for Sierra Online. Like, she just put her thing out, and it instantly was funded. The guys from Double Fine to do their Broken Age, they're just like, hey, we're going to make an adventure game, point and click. Remember those? Instantly funded. Like, So Battle Chasers was such a huge thing. And it's not that long ago. I mean, it was what, early 2000s?
Yeah, it was late 90s, early 2000s.
The way you guys were talking about it, I was like, they're bringing it back from the 30s.
Polio. No. Wes, just sit there. You don't
okay,
have to,
cool, I'm going
to
be pretty.
Battle Chasers, meh.
Yeah,
no,
excited.
Kirigori, you're absolutely right. Kickstarter, they're not all nostalgia-based. I'm just saying, if you look at the ones that make the most funding, most of them are nostalgia-based.
Do you remember when they made that ridiculous amount of money to get the Ninja Turtles back together with Vanilla Ice and do the concert?
No.
What?
Wait, did they? Wait,
is that a
thing? But that just happened.
You told me about this.
Out of their shells?
Jennifer's face?
No,
okay,
I didn't.
Dreams are different from reality, Matt.
This is not a dream. Somebody can look it up. It happened.
Someone Google it.
There's no way that happened without me knowing.
Yeah, I think we would all know about it.
I'm almost positive it happened.
Doesn't matter if it happened or not.
Now you're doubting yourself.
No, I'm not. I just don't want to waste our time on the show arguing about it.
We're talking to you. Can you find that for us? Yeah. Can you please debunk or...
I'm impressed with the Turtles' longevity. Like, I thought they were just a 90s thing, and that cartoon is going strong. Good for them.
It was 25 years until they
came. I wasn't crazy about the movie, I guess, but I mean, I don't know. Like, I love the 90s cartoons, 80s and 90s cartoons so much.
She's a big fan of the movie, for whatever
really?
Reason.
Really?
Here, I'll tell you why.
Right.
I think we wanted the Turtles to grow up with us, right? That's ridiculous. It honestly is. If that franchise is going to have like real lasting longevity, they need to just keep appealing to, you know, the youngins and keep making new generations of Turtle fans. So if you went into the theater thinking like, you know, this movie's not going to be made for me, it's going to be made for like my nephew or my niece, you enjoyed it a lot more. So that's why I liked it. I don't think that's very controversial.
It had some fun stuff, but I think even just like basic like script stuff and I'm totally fine with like wakeboarding turtles dropping emoji references or something.
You know, I just liked that it was violent. I enjoyed that they brought the violence back as opposed to like Ninja Turtles 2, which is my favorite one, but they didn't. Like, Leonardo didn't once draw his katana. I don't think anyone noticed that.
That was the beautiful charm of the cartoon. Like, not once did, like, Leonardo use a sword effectively as a sword.
Yeah.
He was always cutting, like,
pizza.
A tube of tomato paste open.
Yeah.
A shredder would slip on.
Yeah,
same
the only
with
thing
Wolverine.
Oh, yeah,
cartoons.
I love 90s Wolverine.
Like, if it's a robot, he'll go at it. If it's a human,
he was always threatening them, and he shot off at the last second.
Yeah,
the Mausers. He would only destroy the Mausers. I really liked when the Michael Bay one came on Amazon Prime recently, and it had like perfect score for ratings with like 3 ratings, and it had like 5 stars. I'm like, what the hell is going on? Then an hour later, it was down to 3 stars.
My favorite part about Ninja Turtles 2, and I will never get over this, is like obviously like the Vanilla Ice. That's like the official song of the movie and all that.
Yeah.
But within the logic of the movie. Vanilla Ice, the character, is just doing a concert randomly.
Yeah.
And like all of a sudden these turtles come in and just start fighting ninjas and he stops and then the logic of the movie just improvises a song called Ninja Rap.
And all the background dancers.
Yeah, it's this beautiful piece of music.
Well, he just stopped, collaborated, and listened.
He's an artiste.
He is, and he proved it with that movie. But I love that scene so
inspired.
Much.
He was inspired by the moment. Yes. It's an incredible scene. Makes total sense about? When you're a kid.
We're talking about the news. We got more news, right?
We got a lot more news.
Benny, this news.
Yes.
Well, X-Men 92 is such a hit, Marvel's bringing all their characters back to the best decade ever with these 90s variant covers. Neo? Here's just a few coming your way in December. Look for more covers drawn by the likes of J. Scott Campbell and Rob Liefeld as well. Aww. Hey, Rob Liefeld's great. I like Man Boobs.
Good guy.
Can you get more 90s than Rob Liefeld?
No.
You
say
really
by the bell.
Just I want everybody to have huge shoulder pads.
Yeah.
And just rippling muscles.
Pouches, yeah, lots of pouches.
Lots of pouches.
Pouches instead of feet.
And, really bright belts.
Yeah. And guns the size of rooms.
Yes.
Yeah.
I remember they had leg pouches. Like Cyclops had a lot of leg pouches for no reason. Like what was in the I get the chest bandolier what's in the leg pouch?
But also how is that staying up?
Right.
Are you flexing your muscle the entire
what
time?
What is he strapping?
Yeah. I don't even know if that's a pouch cuz it looks like it's just a buckle. Yeah. It helps keep the spandex even tighter.
I get my buckles and pouches confused. Yeah.
Thank you, Neo. Why does the Hulk have a gun?
Hey, it's the 90s. Why question the 90s?
Because you look badass. That's why, okay?
I think everybody started. Telebro's saying the same thing, too. Oh, yeah. Todd McFarlane would be a good one.
That would be a good
one. All right. Sure.
All right. So
more news?
Yeah, yeah. There is apparently, the rumor mill is buzzing.
Yeah.
Might be a new Justice League cartoon coming out. There was a photo on the wall. There was a poster of, it said JLA. With, silhouettes of JLA-esque characters. So,
got it.
It's not an official announcement. That looks, what else could it be?
Wow.
Seems like it, right?
Apparently these posters are of the current lineup and what's to come on Cartoon Network.
Right.
Gotcha.
So that's why people are like, oh, what? Is there a Justice League cartoon coming? Because I think right now Cartoon Network only has Teen Titans Go.
Right.
Yeah, what canceled Beware the Batman.
Yep.
And I think that's the only cartoon that I
have. Wait a second. Is this real? Because there's Looney Tunes on here. There's Tom and Jerry.
So they're going to bring it back?
That's interesting.
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
I wonder what tone they're going to hit. Because I didn't see a ton of Young Justice, but I liked what I saw. That was kind of fun. Yeah. Cool. And that had more of a mature tone, or is it going to be more of a Teen Titans
Teen Titans Go is one of my favorite things to watch at work right now.
It's fun. I think Bruce Timm is back in the fold now, too.
Is he really? Wow.
Well, he's doing Gods and Monsters, which just came out.
But that was that originally separate from DC, right?
What do you mean?
It was more like fan stuff?
No, it was aired through Machinima.
Yeah.
But it was all licensed and collaborative. Yeah, yeah. They came out with the comic book series that's still ongoing, the movie released, and I think the one-shot Machinima season one came out.
The movie was written by, the story was by Bruce, and then the script was written by Alan Burnett, who did the animated series.
Well, what if this is a continuation of Justice League Unlimited?
It's hard to get better than Justice League Unlimited.
Yeah.
Wolverine the X-Men, come on.
I think I read a article why Bruce Timm is like, I don't know if I want to go back to that universe because it was so, it was
perfect.
15 years and perfect.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah.
And it's a perfect book beginning and book ending, and I don't know if you want to mess with that.
Yeah.
So I agree.
Now, a quick interjection here. Moobot has posted Jeff's Twitter. So click on that link, give him a like or a follow, whatever it is that Twitter is. What is it?
It's a follow.
It's a follow, guys. I'm 86 years old.
Yeah, you are.
And that's going to be popping up every 5 minutes. Never mind. More frequently than that.
Minutes. No, thanks, that guys. Just got triggered.
Okay, so there's no excuse. Jeff. Follow him. Otherwise, I will find out.
Okay.
I don't know why I said that.
Vaguely threatening.
She's the police, guys. She's the internet police.
The Bradley Cooper as Rocket Raccoon
image still
has
in your
filled
soul.
Me with rage and murderous intent.
That's okay. You're going to
wear that tomorrow.
Yeah.
Wear that shirt tomorrow. Terrify everybody.
Moving on.
What else do we have?
So it looks like Robert Downey Jr. doesn't get everything he wants. RDJ was the man to thank for bringing Mark Ruffalo on board for next year's Civil War film. Unfortunately, the Hulk's been cut out of the movie. Quick, someone get puppies. That's funny, Lucas. A calm Mark Ruffalo explained, saying, the reason is too great to be revealed in this movie. They want to reveal where he is and why. I don't even know if he's coming back anytime soon. So it looks like we'll have to wait a while to find out where the Quinjet is and where the Hulk is. It's going to be
It's a reference to the end of Avengers: Age of Ultron.
The second one.
All
the
right.
Quinjet, and he flew away in a Quinjet by himself.
Right. Yes.
It's
interesting because General Ross is in Civil War, right? Mm-hmm. They brought in.
Yeah.
He's kind of like the Hulk's main guy.
Is William Hurt? William Hurt's coming back. Mm-hmm. Right?
I think so, right?
Yep.
I would love to see anybody from that movie that no one talks about.
I keep wanting to watch that movie, and
it's
nowhere.
A good movie.
I think it just showed up on FX, but it's like.
Okay.
It's on Netflix.
It's not on Netflix.
Yeah,
Hulk is on Netflix.
If there was a way to watch movies on demand.
Damn it.
But it's not. Like, you have to buy it, and I don't want to buy it. I just want to watch it for free on Netflix.
Do you still have a DVD player?
What?
Do you still have a DVD player?
What is that?
It's kind of like a VHS player.
And Jen's old. What
you know what's weird? I think everybody has the Incredible Hulk on DVD or Blu-ray, but it's only because it was the second movie that came after Iron Man. Everyone's like, well, I don't know how long it's going to take. Like, we're just going to enjoy these Marvel films as long as they're going to make them. And then, like, oh, no, it became a thing.
Yeah.
All right.
Everybody
cool.
Throw it away.
Yeah, we don't care. We have Iron Man 2.
Well, anyway, with this news, rumors started sparking that the Hulk might show up in Guardians of the Galaxy 2, but I think James Gunn already commented saying no.
I think he said no a couple times.
Yeah.
He's getting more angry.
Yeah. Someone get him some puppies. That's how you should have
he's
read
the new
it.
Hulk.
Can those little things go into space, the Quinjets?
Puppies
no.
can. Puppies can.
Wes got me. That's Aww. Wes's. That's my laugh for Wes.
Very good.
That was great.
Thanks. More news.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Yeah,
sorry,
more news,
that.
Matt.
Oh, the whole order change thing.
I just needed to talk about my battle chasers.
Yeah, and apparently I needed to talk about Six Flags again.
Yes.
That's so
Matt has
so many memories.
Just
wait, before
right, so
you go, I have to... Kurigari is creating debate, and I'm not sure if this is an insult. He says, people who like Ruffalo probably like Ben Affleck as Batman. I don't know. Byrne? I have no idea.
I was a big fan of Mark Ruffalo's Hulk. I kind of like how he's just odd.
I like to see that Venn diagram.
It's good.
Yeah, I thought Ruffalo was great. I think Ruffalo is the best choice.
Yeah.
Honestly, like, I loved Ed Norton as the Hulk, but like...
Didn't work out.
I think
Ruffalo
just has more affectation in his voice. He's just a little stranger.
You like his banner better.
Yeah,
like
I
his
do.
Banner isn't as much of an asshole.
Yeah,
yeah.
As
I remember watching the original film and noticing his body language, where he was just like sheathing, like hiding from people. Like that was how he's lived for the past so many years. It's just hiding from everyone.
But Eric Bana is the one true Hulk. I think we can all say that.
Of
right?
course.
Eric
Absolutely.
Yeah. Whatever happened to Eric Bana, guys?
He was in Star Trek, right?
Maybe.
Yes, he was. Yeah. He was a Klingon. Yeah.
I like to remind everyone that Robert Downey Jr. was an Ally McBeal.
He was in Saturday Night Live, too.
And he was in the Tim Allen movie where he became a dog.
And on lots of drugs in the 90s.
Yes, he was.
Yeah. Yeah.
And Charlie Chaplin.
May have informed his
what?
Casting.
Charlie Chaplin?
It was Charlie Chaplin.
It was Charlie Chaplin.
He won an Oscar, guys.
I know.
Oh, my goodness.
All right. Well, run quickly, fool. You better run quickly, fool. To Six Flags, because Six Flags revealed a new DC ride coming your way in the coming months.
Wow.
The Joker ride is set to premiere at their Northern California location, Discovery Kingdom. Justice League Battle for Metropolis will be a 4D experience, but it will be in their Illinois location, so Telebro. And finally, at their Georgia location will be DC Super Friends Kids Area that will feature multiple DC rides like the Joker's Funhouse Coaster and Wonder Woman Flight School. All are expected to premiere this coming 2016 season, so get your tickets now.
Yeah, it's weirder about that.
Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
Well, the Joker ride is set to premiere at there's a Northern California Six Flags?
Yes.
Apparently.
Yeah.
Northern California.
So we get nothing.
In the Bay Area.
We don't get anything.
We have everything already.
Not enough.
Do we have a Joker ride?
We have the Green Lantern.
Yeah, we have that
guys.
Stupid Green
the
Lantern
The Access Chemicals. The centrifuge ride.
But you were saying,
do you just get like thrown into a vat of chemicals?
It's just one of those rides you stand against the wall and
they put on a little red hood.
It's scary because they're like the kids section, the Joker's Funhouse coaster. I'm like, I have so many vivid memories of Joker doing just that Funhouse to awful, sinister.
Yeah,
terrible.
You don't want
to
go into a Joker Funhouse.
Nothing fun about like naked dead people. It's
That's
just
the Alan Moore joke.
If
nothing says
Joker.
Wonder Woman like teaching them how to fly. I get it. He has invisible jet.
If you're in the Joker Funhouse, you better call your daughter to see if she's okay.
Oh,
we can
stuff
do
okay.
speculation.
You know what was the best part about that joke? Is you knew it was really like, oh, this is good. And then halfway through, you're like, I got a power through.
We were vague about it.
She was on point. Well, she's like, it's okay, I run this show.
To clarify for everybody, the Joker's Funhouse was actually the first playset that came out with the Fisher-Price Imaginext line. And they actually released a DVD of it where it was not as dark and more kid-friendly.
Not as dark? How do you do not as dark for kids?
You pretty much do anything other than The Killing Joke. It's automatically less dark. So
make it Pee-wee's Playhouse with the Joker!
Jason Todd's fine, though. It comes with a crowbar.
It's a padded crowbar. It's a padded crowbar.
It's padded. It's Disney.
It's fine.
Disney.
Oh, my God.
It's good.
More news?
Jen.
Oh, yes. New team. I can't get over that last news thing we did. Because you said crowbar. I'm like, the crowbar only creates emotional scarring. Okay, so new details have come to light from the website Bleeding Cool that the Marvel Entertainment Creative Committee, which just disbanded due to Marvel Studios' divorce from Marvel Comics, influenced the films Iron Man, Avengers, Guardians of the Galaxy, Captain America, The Winter Soldier, and Captain America, Civil War. Films they had no involvement in were Iron Man 2 and 3 and Avengers Age of Ultron. Mm. So the speculative question is, maybe this wasn't such a great idea after all? But I mean, we don't know how they influenced it.
But right. Still, like all the great movies that Marvel Studios has produced, they were involved in.
It's correlative, not causative.
But so. Again, like Kevin Feige for years have been very unhappy with reporting to the head of Marvel, which is just didn't work for him. And the female toys weren't a thing because of him. They wouldn't do Black Widow because of him. So I think it's going to be great. There's no limitations, no creative limitations now. Feige's the man.
That's very interesting.
It's going to be cool.
Just something to think about.
Yeah.
Food for thought.
And finally, when it comes to Batman v Superman, looks like Warner Brothers has already chosen their side. It's rumored the studio wants more Batfleck in the upcoming film while edging out Superman.
Oof.
Has this anything to do with the poor box office results from Henry Cavill's Man from U.N.C.L.E.?
It's a difficult name.
Probably not. With the movie coming out in less than 200 days, does the studio have enough time for reshoots? No, probably not.
No. It's weird, isn't it?
No.
It'll just be a really tight shot on like an iPhone of Ben Affleck doing, that's right. Yes. really
just,
bad
just
reshoots.
More of him looking at things really sad.
Yeah.
Oh, sad Batman.
Because that's all
sad
that
Batman, those memes
looks
are
like.
So
I mean,
or angry.
I wasn't crazy. I didn't like Man of Steel very much, but I kind of liked Henry Cavill.
He was great. He was very good.
He wasn't the problem. Yeah, no. He had like, I want to see him, like, I haven't seen all of Man from U.N.C.L.E., but from like the trailers, he looks very charming.
Yeah.
And, like,
yeah.
I would love to see a little bit more of that in Superman. I kind of like a Superman that's like relaxed.
Yeah.
And like the all-star Superman version of Superman.
Like chilling on a cloud.
Yeah. I would
love to see a Boy Scout Superman.
Mm.
Not broody Superman.
Well, I feel like he could be. Like, I always liked Henry Cavill because it felt like, the animated Superman, Tim Daly version, only come to, like, he looked like a freaking action figure. And like you said, not the problem. Good actor, good character.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I've seen Man from U.N.C.L.E. and it's actually a pretty fun
film. How was he in it?
He's great.
Yeah, he seems really charming.
Cool.
You're saying you're a Tim Daly Superman guy. I like George Newbern more, I think. JLU.
But here's the thing. George Newbern is just like doing his best Tim Daly impersonation.
I'm going to disagree here. I think George Newbern brought like more like passion and like he's a bit more conflicted. Like I thought he had a better range. Like, I always thought Tim Daly was just kind of like he always had the same like vocal tone. Whereas George Newbern like got angry or got like very concerned, I kind of liked him.
You know, it's pretty on point. Yeah. One of my buddies who works all in the DC animated version, he goes, Tim didn't know that like being Superman was such a big deal until after George did it, and
everyone reacted
very well to it.
Yeah.
And so Tim was very like protective of his. That's why he did all the Batman Superman directed
really?
DVD movies afterward. And you have a really good point. You could hear a difference in the way he plays the character,
and
his passion. Like watch Public Enemies or anything. Like he's like really. Like,
he got
I'm
more
Superman.
Into it.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, like George Newbern and like for The Man Who Has Everything or like that World of Cardboard speech, like that's good acting.
Yeah.
Like that is just really great vocal
Whenever
acting.
He was against like Darkseid,
for The Man Who Has Everything, when he's like saying goodbye to his son that's been implanted in his mind, like that's very good. That's a great performance.
He's a good actor.
Mm-hmm.
I love the comments are now saying, bring back Dean Cain.
I will defend that. I was about to say, I know I'm going to get hate. I love the casual Dean Cain Superman so much.
So tan. Yes.
He's Rosa like,
Clark is so fun.
Again, like he's just, I guess maybe not so, I don't know if I like the Boy Scout Superman. I like just the relaxed guy Superman. Mm. Like just a slice of Peter Parker, but more competent.
So funny.
Well, to bring it back, it's scrolled by, but it actually did look like Asteroid Man had some pretty cool news. It was regarding a Doritos contest if you direct if you direct a superhero-themed commercial for Doritos, you can actually win a job on the new Justice League movies.
What?
Wow. That's actually
so
pretty cool.
I think everybody in this room should start collaborating.
Everyone needs a best boy.
Let's do some stuff.
I know. That sounds like a great way for them to get a free PA.
Hey, exactly. Guy who has 4 million views on YouTube, tell us what to do, goddammit.
Tell us how to make a viral video.
Can you bring Harrison Ford?
I'll bring Harrison. Yeah.
You guys are besties, right?
Harry and I are really good friends.
Get beers all the time. Yeah. That's cool.
It's hard. Like, and I've been out of like the viral like YouTube competition game for a while. Yeah. But I mean, you just gotta obviously make something good, but also find like the market, if you will. Like
jump cuts. Lots of jump cuts.
So many jump cuts. So and, like, many some jump studio cuts. Apartment background.
Yeah, yeah.
But like, just find like I guess like the quick things. Like it was a Wes Anderson video. It was a Spider-Man video. So there's like the cinephile audience, and there's gonna be just the general kind of comic book audience.
Sure.
There's limitless websites that cater to both of those audiences. So just like bother them with emails, tweet it at them, like, and you know, you maybe you send it to 10 websites, one picks it up, then another one picks it up. Like, you just kind of try to get that snowball effect going.
You have a map now.
Yeah, there you go. That's what I did.
Cool.
Let's do this. Doritos.
All right, guys.
Alfred, bring me 1,000 pounds of Doritos.
Oh no!
Just do and, it. We have to
it actually sounds like it's going to be it's this year's Super Bowl commercial.
Wow, that's excellent.
Yeah. Asteroid Man. He's just blatantly ripping off your sketch, John. John's, you Martian sack of shit.
Thank you.
That's a great way. We could do that.
You got
Damn it,
thank
John.
You.
Lois is my wife.
All right, guys. Well, that finishes that's up the news.
Yes. This is what we do. You guys have just been newsed. Boom.
News.
Newsed in the face. I don't know why we throw this at that very expensive equipment. It
I don't know why either.
But we do it with such
on our accuracy.
We are.
It started that train and it's left the station. We can never go back.
Yep.
Well, that moves us into the most interactive portion of our show, where we put our fate in your hands, or rather, the fate of the two big publishers for this week.
Oh wow!
It is time for the
Danger Room.
Nope.
It's Marvel versus DC, and you at home get to decide who wins.
Yes.
But make sure you guys are tuning in from tglive.com and have the browser Google Chrome or Firefox to be able to vote. DC won it last week. Did you have the board? DC won it last week, so they get to go first. 2-2. It's tied right now, so guys, you need to...
We're freshly, This is our third year doing the show.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, DC took this past year. The year before, Marvel took it, so it's anyone's game now.
All right.
See which publisher is going to win your hearts.
Sorry. The winning team.
I never remember which cable we can unplug and which one.
The losing team has to buy the winning team. I don't know how this works anymore.
Gotcha.
The stakes are high.
Lots on the line. Yeah.
The stakes are really high.
Yep. That's why and how you do it.
In 60 seconds. So it's quick.
I'm gonna burn this place to the ground.
You heard it here first, folks.
Open threats.
We have it on camera.
Ready?
I'm ready when you are.
One minute, go.
All right, guys, I'm taking a risk here because I'm presenting Green Arrow number 44, which actually ties intricately and beautifully into Call of the Wild. So if you guys have never read Call of the Wild, you're not going to know what the hell's going on. But believe it or not, this book is not about Green Arrow, because Green Arrow is basically fed up of his girlfriend, which is something we can all say we've been there, right? But it's actually about the dog. And the dog's story of how it came to be in Green Arrow's life, which is awesome because you wouldn't see this story otherwise. In a very cool twist of fate, it's a half-wolf, half-Siberian husky. They mentioned the Iditarod, which earns points for me. Because the mother, look at how cute the puppies are.
Well, this is why you like this
dog. The mother is actually the lead dog of a sled team, which if you know anything about sled teams, makes perfect sense for why this dog would be so awesome at this. But it's actually tying into a larger story that's brought back Tarantula in New 52, which is awesome. I'm not going to reveal the end of it, but my God, this book is great, and please read it, Green Arrow number 44.
Wow. You have such a hard-on for sled dogs.
I love dogs. Dogs are great.
Nicely done. That was very nice.
It was excellent.
I liked almost every part of that.
I need to see how this magic works.
That was amazing.
Is this your first time with this?
That was the best thing ever.
Oh, good. Okay.
All right. So Team DC has presented Green Arrow
44.
Number 44.
And frustration. 44.
In round one, Marvel.
I wasn't talking about her.
Team Marvel is going to... to counter with?
I'm ready.
Go.
So, guys, I got Thor's number 3. So, in this issue, we get a lot of back and forth with Loki, who's now being interrogated by Ultimate Thor. Thor tries to do the good cop, bad cop thing. Thanks for walking in front of my camera, Wes. And, you know, Loki's seeing right through it. There's this point in the... This thing is, like, freaking out on me. There's this point where Loki's like, does this really technique really work? And Thor looks at him like, sometimes. But yeah, it's not working on Loki. There's a lot of things revealed in this issue. Loki says that there's a lot of Donald Blakes and Jane Foster. Thanks again, Wes. There's a lot of... I'm just saying. There's a lot of Jane Fosters and Donald Blakes in the world that are related to all these Thors and everything like that. It's also revealed that Loki is the only Loki in all of Battleworld, which is kind of amazing. The killer is revealed in this issue. I won't reveal it to you here, but you guys should pick up Thor's number 3.
Here we go. Excellent. So Team Marvel. That's your time.
Being a drama queen.
That was plural, right? Thors?
Yes.
Okay.
Thor's number 3.
I've
so round
this
1.
Book 3 times now.
Yeah, I think we've talked about it before. I just keep forgetting it's a thing.
Round 1 has concluded. We have for your consideration Green Arrow number 44 versus Thor's number 3.
Trace.
Voting is super easy. You go to tglive.com. The poll pops up right on the screen. One click gets you logged in. The second click is your vote. So just hit Marvel or
good
DC.
Argument, buddy.
We're going to put 1 minute on the clock. And go.
I like JLock 21. I don't remember following you people.
We don't follow you either.
Well, JLock, you're tuned into Twin Galaxies Live, where we have a whole variety of programming, so you might not be familiar with the comic book show. We're here every Wednesday from 9 p.m. PST until 11 p.m. PST, or PDT, whichever one. But we also do a whole bunch of world record gaming and classic game spotlights, as well as
gaming
a bunch
with
of new
hot
programming,
chicks.
Like Gaming with Hot Chicks.
Hot Chicks.
Scared Sleepless, where people
also
play terrifying video games, and all kinds of other awesomeness.
There's a, don't let this influence your guys' vote at home. But Jeff, which one were you swayed to?
You know, I have not read either of those this week. I've had kind of a busy week doing press. I loved the last Daredevil issue, actually. So I'm going to go with Marvel, just because Daredevil's in the Marvel universe.
I'm very sorry. The logic behind it.
Yeah. I bleed Marvel. Marvel's paid me more, I suppose, than DC. And, but I like George Newbern's Superman, so take that as a grain, as an olive branch.
Sure.
I'm going to go, I love Battleworld, I love Secret Wars, I'm going to go with the world that they're setting up in Thor's.
Cool.
Let your vote doesn't count.
Go ahead,
well, let's
right
take
now.
A look at our polls right now. It looks like DC has taken round one handily. 87.5% of you
Green
voted
arrow.
For DC, which moves us into, and the poll sounds like it's been double confirmed by our man in the booth here. That means DC gets to present first again for round 2.
Yep.
Let's see if Marvel can put one on the board or if DC's going to keep doing it. Ready? Boom! A minute.
You guys, it's Batmite number 4. Booster Gold and Batmite teams up. This happens and it's amazing. So, yes, Batmite, he has a roommate now, and you can guess that he's not the best roommate. He burns pretty much everything to the ground, including this chick's photo album, which comes back into the book later. And then Booster Gold busts in with Skeets, and this is amazing because it's the first time they meet in this universe, and Batmite was like, you know what, I'm not really buying your origin story or your name, so I'm gonna come up with stuff myself. He names him Black Gold and makes him like do an entire costume change. It's hilarious and really funny. There's also a lot of snippets like, you should make a gold cave or a fortress of Booster Tude. 9 seconds. Guys, this is such a fun book, really fun art. These guys have great banter. And pick up Batmite number 4, which is out last week. Good stuff. Good book.
Mm-hmm.
Funny book.
Random aside, I can't look. I read Batmite this week.
Yeah.
And actually, every book that we present was from last
week,
guys,
so there's no spoilers.
Yeah. We're not. So if you haven't read it, it's from last week. It's not from today.
Hilarious.
With that said, I cannot read Batmite without picturing Ben doing the voice for Batmite.
That's what makes it better. That's what I did the whole time.
I love
I don't know why.
It's Batmite and Booster Gold really polarizing in the chat, by the way.
But it's people so are like, good, you guys. Especially because now that I hear Ben's voice and I think of Nathan Fillion, it's just like, Ben and Nathan Fillion together? I'd like to watch that.
I wouldn't.
Who wouldn't?
All right, Ben.
Okay, Ben. In the Batmite voice.
Now that I've insulted you for some reason, completely unprovoked, please present.
How am I doing it?
Give him a little primer. Technology, it's our friend.
Stop like your real Uriel says, Gooster, okay, bold and the brave.
Just trying to
kind of. It was excellent.
Don't zoom?
It was a lot of fun.
All right.
I wrote so much stuff, and I tried to get through all of it.
Okay.
Because zooming and stuff will mess you up.
Ready?
Okay.
And 1 minute, go.
So, I'm presenting Deadpool versus Thanos, issue number one. Basically, it's Deadpool getting the crap beaten out of him by Thanos. It starts off because, if you guys don't know, Deadpool is also in love with Mistress Death, who is Thanos' girl. So, it's one of the reasons why Deadpool is now immortal, is because Thanos cursed him with eternal life so that he can never die, so he can never be with Mistress Death. It then flashes, you see him getting the crap beaten out of him, here. That's his face getting shoved into the ground. And then it flashes back to the time where Deadpool just happened to go see Dr. Doom in his paradise house and murdered him.
What?
Tell yeah. But guess what? Guess what? Sorry, Doom isn't dead because Thanos has made it so no one can die on Earth. Oh God, I only have five. Anyway, I have no time. It's great. Really great. There's zombies and.
Marvel.
Marvel. There's things that happen with zombies. I think.
There are zombies.
Maybe.
Bold argument. Yeah.
Oh God.
All right, guys. That
I don't
was
like that
round two. The conclusion of round two. We it's have some interesting team ups here. We have Booster Gold and Batmite versus on Team Marvel. We have Thanos
Deadpool and Thanos.
Yep.
Deadpool versus Thanos.
Versus Thanos.
A lot of verses.
We're gonna put a minute up on the clock for you guys to vote. TGLive.com is where you make that happen. And go.
If you and I were...
Your real Uriel, wasn't Deadpool already immortal? I asked that very same question to our good friend Lucas here.
Yeah, he just has healing powers.
He just has super healing powers.
Yes.
He wasn't able to... He was able to die up until 2013 when they introduced the storyline of him actually courting death. And Thanos comes in and says, "Hey, fuck you." That's what Thanos sounds like.
His healing factor...
It's a Dick Tracy villain.
I'm old Purple Chin.
His healing factor is a lot better than what Wolverine and Hulk's is. Like, he can be decapitated and still be able to talk and be alive and everything. He just, like, puts it back on and everything's copacetic.
It's handy.
Yeah.
If you and I were Batmite and Booster Gold,
yeah,
which of us would be which one?
People probably want me to be Batmite.
You'd be Batmite?
I think people would want me
I
to be
I think
Batmite.
You're a little zanier than I am.
Maybe.
But I'd like to see a Batmite who's like Ben calm Knight. And collected.
I think you're just like Batman. Calm and collected people.
He's
just
showing Batmite.
He's just like, be cool, guys. Be cool,
just
Superman.
Be cool, it's not
be
a big
cool
deal.
Batmite.
What is Batmite's origin, if we have time?
We do.
He's Silver Agey, right?
He is. He is from the same dimension as Mr. Mixius Pitlick.
Okay.
Because
is that how you pronounce that?
That is how you pronounce that.
That's the legit way to do it.
Do that again?
Mixius Pitlick.
Mixed, that's impossible. I'm never going to say that.
MXYZPTLK.
And how do you say his name backwards?
Kiltipsic. No, that was wrong.
That's the only way to get rid of him, right?
Kiltipsic.
Oh my God. Sounds like a dirty word in like Swedish or something.
Yeah, it does.
It does sound like
okay, so he's from the same dimension.
He's from the same dimension as Mixius Pitlick. And basically, Mixie got in a fight with another imp from that dimension who said, like, look, we've got it all wrong. It's way more fun over there. But they got a fight saying, like, no, you can't fight Superman. So I think his actual origin story was in a Superman book where he tried to be Superman. And then they kind of retconned it where it was like, okay, that failed. And then he became enamored of Batman, still back in the Silver Age.
Yeah.
So with a lot of the ridiculous stories that were going on, they kind of tried to write him off being like, oh, this is because this guy. But DC started taking him seriously in the Nightfall crossover, where they actually did Mightfall was the storyline.
He was in the Nightfall series?
They gave him a one-shot prestige where it was Mightfall. and it was all about him reenacting the entire thing.
right.
Was there
and after that, he was actually in the canonical DC universe.
So. I wanted an adorable Bane.
An adorable Bane.
I think it was.
Is it like a calm, collected Bane?
It's a calm, collected Bane.
Got it.
He's just a cool Bane.
It's just a chibi Bane.
Bane, what are you doing?
Marvel took that round.
He's high all the time.
He is.
We won.
Marvel won. That means we move into round three. Team Marvel, hit us with something else.
Are you prepared to talk about Groot?
Oh, yeah, I can talk about Groot or something else. Or do you want Groot?
You want to do something else?
I'll go Daredevil if you want. That was my favorite. I'm not that narcissistic. I'll go.
Talk about my stuff.
My choice of the week. Yeah, just loved the Mark Waid run on Daredevil so much. I take that over. I'll take that over the Brubaker, the Bendis stuff. Even like, I loved. It is dark, but just the actual tone, and like the art style. It's so cavalier and fun and bold. Stephen Wacker was the editor that kind of pushed that through. Really cool guy, and they just they brought a really like huge tone shift to Daredevil, and I think it stuck. And Chris Samnee's done some of the most creative and like visually interesting work that I think I've seen Marvel in like, the last like 5 years or so. And so this was the end of the run. And also, like, as far as female characters go, they made a Daredevil girlfriend that didn't like die or become some sort of like drug addict or something. Like, Kirsten McDuffie's a really cool lawyer character, and the issue that dealt with depression was a pretty poignant issue as far as Marvel goes, is this Purple Man saga that they did. I recommend it. Check it out. Daredevil's he's kind of the coolest. Well, everyone likes the dark and gritty, like Netflix Daredevil. That's the direction they're probably going to go. It makes a lot of sense. It works. It's like really fun. I think this is a special gem of a run, and I think everyone should check it out.
Cool.
My favorite part about that is Run Quickly goes, Jeff sounds so calm and collected.
Almost like he thinks a minute is longer than 60 seconds. And he didn't even need the 60 seconds.
He's just like a cool Jeff. It's just cool like Jeff. A cool version of it.
Is he Jeff Might?
There's no such thing as a cool Jeff. There's never been a guy named Jeff who's cool.
You know who's cool, Jeff? Hefe's.
Yeah, Hefe's different. Yeah.
Jeff Goldblum.
Yeah, is he cool or is he just he's unique? Like,
he's quirky.
He's eccentric.
So weird
eccentric.
That he's cool.
Okay.
Is there a cool Jeff?
He's cool the way Steve Buscemi is.
I don't know a lot of Jeffs.
Yeah, hey, Wes, you remember the interview that we did down at WonderCon?
Yeah, with Jeff King.
Jeff!
He's so cool.
Jeff.
So we're here with Jeff.
Good job.
Yeah, he had no idea who Jeff King was. He was like...
And they just shoved me out there.
That's great.
Like, and I was like, Jen, who is he? And she thought I was like hyping myself up. Yeah. Like, who is he? And she's like, great, go. And I'm like, okay, hi.
We turned the camera on.
What are you here talking about?
He went, so Jeff, what do you do?
What's going on with things?
We have to do that on like anytime we have to do maybe like a red carpet bit, or we'll send like a correspondent. Like, you have to be on the lookout for people.
With the little name card.
Yeah, we were at the I think it was the MTV Movie Awards, and I'm old. I don't know who these people are. All like these MTV starlets. I'm like, hey.
Aaron.
Hey, you're attractive. Come talk to us. Do you think? So what's like, going on?
You know, supporting character from Teen Wolf. You're like, all right, what's going on, man?
Congratulations on things.
Yeah.
Teen Wolf. Yep.
Well, it could have been just a vagrant. I don't know.
We decided to put on a gown for the team.
Amazing.
We're going to put a minute up. Oh, wait, no. DC Team DC hasn't gone. I just figured they'd been.
Nope.
All right, ready?
No.
You wanna?
Yep, you're ready and go.
I think. What?
Go. Jeff King.
You got 30 seconds.
I think you should do a video.
You think?
Yeah.
Right. You're gonna do a video.
You haven't done a video in like 100 years.
Right now.
We're gonna do a video.
Yeah.
And.
Nope. And Neo should not.
While they're loading up that, have you watched any of the BuzzFeed red carpet videos?
That's super bad.
Oh, I don't. I've seen a lot of BuzzFeed videos. I'm not sure about what are they doing on the red carpet.
They've started going to these red carpet events, and it's really funny because a lot of these like web places are doing red carpet now, but because most people don't care about red carpet, like their PR people just
move them through. We've had that. Yeah.
So BuzzFeed had started doing like, look at all these people who are ignoring BuzzFeed. How fast can we get them to run away?
Why would you ignore BuzzFeed, though? They have such a...
This was before BuzzFeed. This was, like, when they first started doing their video stuff.
Okay. And, like, on those events, like, I think I had to go down to any awards, I guess, like movie awards, like the Oscars. You will not believe how many random, like, web channels there are.
Yeah.
And you think you know, but there's... And then, like, in every language as well. It's like, oh wow, there's like this, you know, Latvian like web series that wants to interview you, and just all like it's. Fills up all of Hollywood Boulevard, so yeah. I can't imagine.
But they don't get anything because they just
no, yeah, yeah it's this huge crapshoot. Like they'll go to like Entertainment Tonight, and then you know that's it.
Yeah. Adventures.
All right, so I believe are ready.
Yep.
You're gonna have them cut it at 1 minute, or is it less than a minute?
It's less than a minute.
And go.
See a familiar voice. It's gonna be nifty. Audra's good. It's good. Can they hear me over? Oh, sweet, great. So yeah, pay attention. A familiar voice coming
it's
up.
Quiet. Too quiet. Except for the theremin music. Cyborg, would you please stop it?
Sorry, I was just having a little bit of truck!
Welcome to your defeat, Justice League. Aww. Defeat at the hands of the Legion of Doom.
The Trickster?
Trademark. Legion of Doom?
Petrified Pandora.
Villains working together?
I did not see that coming.
Is that Mark Hamill?
Yeah.
That was Mark Hamill.
Captain Cold?
Mark Hamill. Yeah, we're done.
As Captain Cold?
Isn't that awesome? He's doing stuff.
Yeah. Yep. That's how it goes.
All right, so round three is concluded. We have our guest, Jeff Loveness, presenting Daredevil. There we go.
Dead Devil.
Daredevil versus Team DC is presented Mark Hamill. It was revealed this week, providing the voice of
The Trickster.
The Trickster in the new Legos. Other people. The new Legos. DVD. And 1 minute to vote. Go.
Curlia, you need to go to tglive.com.
Gotta say, that was a pretty weak Legion of Doom, Legion of Doom lineup, though. If you're running against Superman and Black Manta and Captain Tiger.
When I first saw it, it was Tigress. Yeah. And then, I saw it.
I think the League's got this one. They've got Superman and Lantern.
Spoilers. They probably make it through. When I first heard it, I'm like, oh my god, the Joker, this doesn't fit this weird, tiny child version of the Legos. I'm like, oh, different character. Yeah. Okay, well, that fits.
Have Sinestro and Superman thrown down a lot? I'd like to see that.
Interesting.
They have. They did a lot Injustice. Big time.
Okay.
Big time.
How'd that go down?
It was a great series.
Fucking vote Marvel.
Vote Marvel. Sorry.
No, you want to vote DC. We're talking about DC stuff. Okay,
Daredevil,
cool.
You owe it to Daredevil and the bright, optimistic storytelling of Mark Waid that plunges into the depths of depression and comes out on the other end.
Or some Legos.
Well-drawn female characters that have frailties and strengths.
It's over, Jeff. It's over.
Oh no, we have tied.
Why was Cyborg only slightly tan as a Lego?
I didn't notice. I don't see color, Ben.
Legos don't have black. Well, it is a Swedish company.
Neo is there. Is that correct?
No, it's not. DC one, right? Cool.
Ooh. According to Guru, they always update in live in real time now, so they're always correct.
Well done. Okay.
Yeah.
It'll always be.
Well, it is correct.
We move into round four.
Three is a tie.
Team Marvel, you got a minute.
Well.
And meanwhile, we should definitely plug the fact that the show is in part brought to you by our dear sponsors over at House of Secrets right here in beautiful Burbank, California. Why don't you tell us a little bit more about
Burbank? Because we're going for the win.
It's a brick-and-mortar store, so if you guys are ever in Burbank, definitely be sure to swing by. It's probably our favorite comic book shop nationwide. Definitely our favorite comic book shop locally. They have a huge selection of back issues and an incredibly knowledgeable staff that will be able to point you in the right direction of anything you're looking for or guide you towards some awesome stuff if you're not sure what you want to check out. But they also sell online, so you guys can click that link that just got posted, artoffiction.com/House of Secrets.
The digital store.
And every book that we have presented is available digitally right now, so you guys can check them out for yourselves and find out what we're not telling you.
You know what's a cool part about that store that not a lot of comic book stores do? Is they have a how-to section, so they have like a very comprehensive library of you know, you want to be an artist or a writer or an editor, and a bunch of videos. Such a cool store.
They actually just opened up a new back room. Mm-hmm. They are going to chain Jeff there, and he's going to teach you how to write.
Oh, good. Good job. Or do a lifetime of slavery.
No Daystar for you.
No.
This is how they've decided to tell you.
I was hoping there was something else behind the beaded curtain. This is how we I guess I'll learn how to write.
So you're literally never going outside
again. As far as, like, chained to slavery, that's not the worst. That's, like, the best possible punishment. I just teach people how to write. Like, I'm not, like, trapped in some sort of, like...
It's not like breaking cinder blocks with
usually it goes
sledgehammer.
Way worse.
I don't think they have a working toilet, though.
That's all right.
Well, that's when the day stars in the sky.
Yeah.
When the night stars out.
Yeah, yeah. So is this the tie-breaking round?
No, this is a new round. It's
just a new
ties
round.
Just we skip and move to the next round.
What's the score right now?
1-1.
1-1.
Oh, my gosh. Okay. All right, so we got a minute. Let me know when you're ready, and I'll hit that button.
Go for it.
Go.
Get it.
All right, we went with Daredevil first. Although, you know, if you like Groot, if you like kind space trees, check out Groot number 4. Came out last week. This is this one's for the X-Men fans. If you look to your right, you'll see a very iconic pose made by one Wolverine. Oh, no. Oh, no. And this is an idea I had from the very beginning. Everyone loves Baby Groot. You can't do a Groot series without Baby Groot.
That's fair.
And so let's not spoil it. Something happens to our good friend Groot. But I wanted to have an evocative image that, like, would get people to read number 5 and set up Baby Groot very well. And so I thought, what's, like, the coolest, like, comeback in comic book history? Like, what's the coolest sort of, like, one panel shot? I'm like, oh, you go Uncanny 132, you do Wolverine coming out of the sewer, like, and you do kind of the now it's my turn pose. Yeah, but instead of a mangy Canadian, it is Baby Groot.
Yay!
So I hope you guys liked that callback. It felt really cool to see that from January until now.
Nice. Nicely done.
That's all for another video.
Very cool. Look.
I could do another round of comics.
People freaked out.
I could do another round of.
I just
books.
And I'll do like the page turn.
Read to us.
Josie Wins is wearing a Baby Groot T-shirt right now. What a coincidence! And Greg says Batman's parents.
Oh,
they come back?
They didn't come back.
No.
Oh snap!
Oh, I have bad news. I have bad news. They're dead.
Did you see the Conan O'Brien thing with the...
Oh, yeah, yeah, he killed Batman's parents.
Brilliant. Oh, no, the Waynes are over in that alley. No worries.
Thanks, kid.
So good.
All right, ready?
Trying to decide. Okay.
And go.
For round 4, DC presents Batman Beyond number 4. Terry McGinnis is gone, and now it's Tim Drake in the future,
oh, yeah.
And everything is really, really bad, if you guys can't tell from
shit
the panels.
Shit's crazy.
I love the art in this book. It's actually really cool that they took the animated style and yet made it very pretty, so it's no longer just the rigid kind of... super animated
like
style. It's got a great callback to the Joker gang who has been surviving in the underbelly of Gotham while Brother Eye has been trying to find them. The Joker gang actually incites chaos by trying to let the Brother Eye in, which is super, super bad, but it ends up really badly for them. There's a great panel right there of one of the Joker gang getting impaled through the face, which I think we all wanted. If you ever watched the Batman Beyond animated series.
Tim didn't.
So this is very different from what you watched back then, but it's so good. I can't recommend this book highly enough, but seriously, Tim Drake as the new Batman Beyond in Batman Beyond number 4.
Excellent artwork.
Nice. All right.
Beautiful. It's like epic.
So there we go, guys. Round 4. We have Groot, as written by Jeff Loveness. Presenting
some writer.
Versus Batman Beyond.
Number 4.
Number 4.
He's not
1
here.
Minute to vote starts.
Batman's
right.
Not that popular.
Now.
You know that.
Listen, Ackerman.
Yeah,
it's
a fly-by character.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
but
Batman.
If Batman's not that popular, what about Beyond Batman? We could call him Batman Beyond.
or Batman of the future in Europe.
I have to say, I'm currently playing through Arkham Knight.
Yeah?
And I think you just gave a spoiler. I really
no.
hope
really?
That's not true.
No.
Okay,
you're
great.
Good.
What?
Though I have to say the math is perfect.
That's
one,
good math.
One kid minus two parents plus $4 billion equals justice.
You know what I realized playing Arkham Knight? Like, I never realized this until that game. How much Alfred must like hate Batman? Because like it's in that game, it is like 4 a.m. and this is like an 80-year-old man.
Yeah.
Every 5 seconds, like, Alfred, I need schematics of those airships. It's like,
yeah,
god damn it,
that's
man.
Such a good call.
I'm very tired.
There's so many arcs that go back to like, Master Bruce, you can't keep doing this to yourself. I want like one panel be like Alfred, like, I am 82.
Yeah.
It is 3 a.m. I don't give a shit about you.
I don't know how to get schematics.
Oh, you're hurt? You need bandaging? Go to a hospital. Maybe. I'm asleep.
There was in the animated series, wasn't there a bunch of him, Alfred, in pajamas?
Yeah.
There's a bunch of sequences where Alfred is just in pajamas.
In my head, I just see this sketch where he's got like a can of Ensure that he really wants to drink. Yeah. And every time he...
Alfred!
He's just like, God, okay.
Alfred!
No, I say,
stabbed or on fear gas.
I'm on a part in Arkham Knight where Lucius Fox is kind of just peaced out, which I'm like, okay, that's what he should have done. Just leave.
It's the weekend. He's like, gone. Gonna go with my kid to see them go to the museum.
Work hours are done.
Maybe get out of this horrible town. A little bit.
Well, it looks like. Oh, what?
Yeah.
DC took that with Batman Beyond.
It's because of that spike in the face. Great. It was pretty cool.
You guys are mean. Cool. So, you know, we have the comic book writer presenting his own comic book, and you voted for Batman Beyond. Jerks.
I get it.
Yeah, but he doesn't really understand the story or the voice of the book.
It goes back to the whole Kickstarter thing. It's the nostalgia value. People are nostalgic about Batman Beyond.
Yeah,
so.
That's true. Yeah.
And it was like, it was really like, I've been waiting for years for the Jokers to just get worked. Yeah. Because all series long, you know, it's this gang who's harassing poor Terry. Yep. And Terry sucks at being Batman. So he gets the crap beaten out of him all the time by these Jokers.
Yeah.
So it was really good to see, like, the Jokers are like, chaos, dead.
I don't know if it's a spoiler, sorry, and feel free to skip, but did they say what happened to Terry McGinnis, or is that...
They did. It happened back at Future's End. He traveled back in time to try and prevent Brother Eye from taking over.
Uh-huh.
Got killed.
Oh, that hurt.
And he, like, it's really sad because in the beginning of Batman Beyond Now, Tim Drake traveled back to the future and had to say hi to Matt, who, if you remember the series, Matt was Terry's little brother. So it's like this little 5-year-old who's like, I'm the new Batman, your brother's not coming back.
He didn't need to tell him that.
Well, no, because it was like, that's Terry's suit,
he
but how come Terry hasn't
he
come back?
He could have told him anything. She said, kid, your brother found the love of his life. Decided to
he
stay
did.
There.
In the past, he found plastic.
I feel like we're seeing behind closed doors of what happens in the bedroom of Matt and Jen.
We just argue.
That's a different subject.
They just argue
that's
about Batman.
That's a different
Batman.
Subject. But Matt has a great point about the book, where Terry does suck, because he's just taking Bruce's orders the whole time. He's relying on the suit, and now we get to see a person who's worked under Batman for 30 years,
right.
And what he can do in the suit is like pretty fucking cool. So, I totally agree.
I don't know the Batman Beyond universe that well. Whatever happened to Dick Grayson? I thought Tim Drake was killed by the Joker in Return of the Joker movie and all
so
that.
So, no. Tim Drake wasn't killed. He was just, like,
tortured.
That's right.
And now he, like, works for an IT company or something.
Oh,
yeah, he didn't give it up.
That's right. Okay,
he's, like,
punchy. What about Nightwing?
We don't know for sure, but, he became Nightwing, and they don't talk, and he's a Bloodhaven, and now, it's just a bunch of egos.
Okay, so
No.
In the Batman Beyond Unlimited series, you actually find out that Bruce was used to working alone after Tim quit,
right.
And Dick came back for a little while as Nightwing to try and help get him back together. Going into the super deep lore, Bruce Wayne ended up sleeping with Dick's girlfriend, Barbara Gordon, her pregnant.
Yep.
She had a miscarriage.
Yeah.
And on their last night out, when they tried to go out together, Batman was so used to working alone that he threw his cape to dodge. All the bullets went right through the cape and right into Dick Grayson, who survived it. He lost an eye and was like, fuck this, I'm out.
Sure.
So
Batman
Beyond series is really good.
Some deep shit. So when you see it on screen in like the kid show, and they're like, why are they so like, there's so much tension. There's a lot of tension there for a good reason.
Yeah, okay.
There's
I didn't
good
know
reason
that.
There.
Jeez.
Yeah, Asteroid Man, that actually
Astro Man's like,
it was actually alluded to in the animated movie universe. If you ever watched Mystery of the Batwoman, which is the best part of that. Did you ever watch that one?
No, I never saw that one.
It's really weird. Barbara Gordon calls Bruce Wayne, and he's like, oh, I'm going through a tunnel, and he puts his phone in a paper bag and starts smashing it. Like, that actually happens.
I can't talk right now. It's bad service.
You're
Batman!
Yeah.
I'm great with women.
Intimacy is no.
All right, guys. Well,
so at the bottom of round four.
Five, four. Doesn't matter.
No, that was the bottom of round four because we had DC won the first round, Marvel won the second round, right. Third round was tied, DC took the fourth round. So at the top of round five, DC is leading with 2-1. If DC wins this round, DC takes this week.
Let's do it.
Okay. This is just going to happen. Yep.
All right.
I have trust in my teammate. We'll see. I have no idea what's about to happen. We didn't
it's
talk
just
about
a
it
video
before
of Wes dancing while stroking his head.
Oh, God. You could just do that live on the show. He doesn't have to make a video about
Barbara
it.
Gordon, huh? Interesting.
Asteroid Man says he's like 100 times her age. I don't think he's 100 times Barbara Gordon's
Maybe 10.
Age.
Well,
I'm
10
not
going
to describe this at all. I'm just going to let this happen.
All right.
Because I enjoyed it thoroughly.
If
ready?
It's not what Ben says it is, I think we'll
No, it's not. This, I had to search hard for this.
Ready?
This is interesting. Yeah.
Go?
Well, whenever it starts.
Okay.
So don't start it yet.
yep. Yeah, looks great.
Definitely looks so don't good. Start it yet.
Nope.
Issues.
Boulder One structures.
I thought this was part of it.
This is a great video. Batman tries to use a new operating system.
Alfred, update my
Alfred,
update my settings.
Hurt my bandages.
Alfred, I hear that Windows 10 is out.
Alfred, why did you upgrade me to Yosemite?
Girl, sorry, I do.
Update all the
back
computers. Alfred, I want the new Apple Watch.
Then buy the fucking Apple Watch.
Okay.
Last Lois Lane, your girl told me I do all the things you couldn't. She told me last night that you were faster than a speeding bullet. Just accept it, you probably need some extends. You got that icy cold breath and still need a breath mint. You're in the square with me, how could you dare to be? I'm about to make this Kryptonian bow down and swear to me. Billionaire, when I see you, I'm robbing you. Don't move, Mr. Freeze, or I'm popping you. And yeah, I hate that girl, she knows I'm mad at her. I'll riddle her with dead shots until her back splatters. Bruce, you'll get sent to the ER if you try me. Then I'll fly to your room and put poison in your IV. My heat vision got you looking like a California raisin. I'm a beast boy, got the whole crowd raving! Drop the alien panic, you need to take a Xanax. Strangle you with your own cape and hang you from the Daily Planet. Gotham will topple Metropolis, tried and true. Look up in the sky, is it a bird, a plane, or a douche? Your secret identity is a pair of lens trappers, red underwear, boots? That suit's a disaster. Kal-El just caught the...
Yeah.
Good timing. All right. What that
was that amazing.
Yeah,
that was this week?
Yeah, that was this week. It came out from, like, Sweden or something.
All right.
Yeah. All right. Well,
I'm looking this up later, and if it's more than a week, then you're disqualified.
Yeah, I don't care about what
All right.
But it did come out this week, so it was enjoyable.
Did you check Team Marvel, counter that, I guess. Well, I don't know what that was. Something from Sweden, Batman and Superman. With a lot of clever references to names.
See, it seemed like an epic rap battle.
Okay, credit where credit is due. I'll put poison in your IV.
Yeah.
That was pretty good.
That was good
pretty
word
good.
Play.
It was really good.
Like, the rest of it, all right, hilarious. That was like, wow, that actually, I'd never thought of it.
I'll Riddler.
Oh, that's too.
Oh,
yeah, terrible.
Ready?
Ready.
Go.
So, guys, I got Silk number 7. This is before the world is about to end for Secret Wars. I like when books make me laugh, make me cry, and make me excited, and this book makes me do all three. So everyone knows the world is ending. J. Jonah Jameson has been helping Cindy Moon try to help her find her parents, and he's like, hey, I have this lead. Maybe you can check it out. But it's not about her parents, it's actually about her brother, who she never got to say goodbye to when she went into the bunker. And should I spoil it and let you know if she found her brother or not? But on her way to go check this lead, she doesn't know if she's going to see her brother or not. But, you know, the world's in trouble. She's trying to save people, and the seconds are counting down to when the world's about to end. And I think I am going to spoil it. She does find her brother, and it's, like, right before the world ends, and it's very sad. So number 7, pick it up.
Oh, hey, by the way.
There we go. Silk number 7, guys. This is round 5. We have Silk number 7 versus this video that it looks like Wes has now confirmed was actually released this week. What
September
is it called?
9th.
That's today.
Yeah, I know.
What's it called?
Are you sure it's not a
repost? It's a...
Because I feel like I've seen it before.
What is the YouTube? The YouTube name is Batman vs. Superman Rap Battle Turkche Alt Yazili.
You guys, come to vote tgLive.com while they figure out how to.
The description is.
Posted on top trending on July 26th.
Oh!
Well, I found it's, but this one.
Disqualified.
Oh, it doesn't matter.
Disqualified.
It doesn't matter. Today. Oh.
Disqualified.
No, this one posted today.
You've done your research.
I did.
Oh, so let me.
This one came out today.
Let me just take
that's
Wes.
That's not that
Wes
one.
Anderson's
that's not
Spider-Man.
That one.
This was a Turkish one.
Let me just take Wes Anderson's Spider-Man and repost it on my YouTube channel, and then it came out today.
It was an excellent one.
So that, that's disqualification
views from the wrong place.
I don't know what to do.
I'm the victim here now.
The Turkish version came out today.
Okay, well,
the
Marvel
Turkish version
automatically
wasn't
wins.
Turkish.
Well, no, it's in the title. It's in the title. Ben, so there. Turkish.
I don't know what to do. We okay, do
well, the Turkish subtitled one.
It's no, it's in the it's in the title, like in the video.
It's in English.
I know it's in English. But the guy edited it.
So I'm gonna, you know what, in the interest of time, I'm gonna make it good.
Yeah.
So, Team DC has won this
yeah,
one.
We did!
Wow. I guess the truth means nothing.
Yeah, like,
the truth means nothing.
Hey, you know what? I wanna give a shout out to a big help from the impartial tech guy. Oh yeah,
he researched it for 2 seconds and found it on another thing in July.
I guess
this is fine because next week I'll just be showing the Deadpool trailer. Check it out. I'll be posting it on my YouTube channel.
Okay, well there is something that we can all agree on. In the interest of time, since we can cut this short, we have more time for questions for Jeff.
Yay!
Having him contribute to the Infinity Gauntlet, which is the next segment, and we'll just do one really really good one, and then we'll do questions.
Cool.
More questions.
So wait, let's get an intro for the Infinity Gauntlet.
Oh yeah.
You should. Would you mind wearing that glove?
Oh, I don't.
For just
much
one
power?
Second. Sure.
Now you do. Now it's in your power.
And
so now we're ready for the intro.
Go. Yeah.
So hey, you guys, it's time for the Infinity Gauntlet. This is where you guys give us your favorite characters, and we pit them to a battle to the death.
Indeed, it's as easy as that sounds. You just start saying things.
Say things, and we talk about them in depth. Sometimes too much.
Groot versus Swamp Thing.
I knew that was. Didn't I just?
Right.
Did you call that?
Groot
versus Harrison Ford. Are we talking like witness Harrison Ford, or
I think
like,
it has to be like
honestly,
your version.
I feel like Harrison Ford would just smoke Groot at this point.
Get closer.
Like literally smoke him in a joint. Harrison Ford is high a lot, is what I'm saying.
Groot versus Poison Ivy. Call that one to
Groot versus Poison Ivy. Yeah, yeah.
Stocked.
Oh, we'll let Jeff pick one then.
Let's dive into Groot versus Poison Ivy. All right. Do you think she has full control over him, or he's such a sentient being?
Matt. Do the thing about how everything's in his power.
No, that's Swamp Thing. We're talking about Poison Ivy.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, Poison Ivy versus Groot has some sort of, he
can generate life, he can kind of extend himself, recreate himself, all that. So he has some sort of like biological...
Yeah, so then Poison Ivy would have control.
You think so?
Here's the thing, I do not think, because he's plant-based, I don't think Poison Ivy would kill him.
She loves him.
She would probably let him... But he wouldn't kill her.
Perhaps, and she only loves plants, but plants are not really sentient things. So she and Groot fall in love. She found a plant that she can actually fall in love with.
And he lets her talk.
Yeah,
which is cool.
Yeah.
If maybe he's not plant based, maybe because his alien biochemistry is so different.
He's
maybe
a floral colossus, which I'm not even sure what that even means. But it's some sort of like tree entity.
Do you guys?
He's plant-based. You could kind of say, right?
So different, like the alien?
It's foreign, but I think she's into that. It's like you're meeting like a
man on Earth are boring.
Yeah, like you're meeting like someone from Chile. And you're like, oh, a cool person.
That's funny.
Well, I think we're going about this maybe the wrong way. Could Poison Ivy kill Groot?
No,
I don't think she would. But she wouldn't.
I don't even think she could.
There's just a splinter left. He'll come back.
Exactly. So I kind of think that no matter what Poison Ivy throws,
she's
not
going to
keep, like,
she could detain him, though.
Weed killer around. So I can't imagine that she would be able to kill Groot. Mm.
The fun, horrible thing about this thing that we do, the Infinity Gauntlet segment, is that we force a death situation. If one of them is walking out of the room alive and the other one is not.
Right.
Who would...
What's happening?
Who?
Okay, so let's just say they were in a relationship. You know, someone messed up in the relationship and things gets heated. And, you know, one of them needs to get their mouth burned shut.
Good lord, Lucas.
Which
I would go. I think I would go with Poison Ivy in the way of like she can control. At the end of the let's go on the assumption she can control plant life.
Okay, so we're going with OP Poison Ivy.
He's resistant to it, but she can still like manipulate it.
Okay.
And there's like a threat. I think she could like just tear him apart and like maybe detain him and like stop him from growing back because she can control him, right? So rip him to a splinter and keep that splinter like around her as like a trophy of her domination.
That bitch.
I think she's pretty tough.
See, I would actually argue for the opposite because it's interesting. Like her powers are right. She can biologically kind of do mind control stuff on particularly on men, and she controls plant life. But she doesn't have any like other than that. She doesn't have any killing powers in something against in a fight with Groot. He's super strong. He's super.
And sometimes he's like very violent.
He can be very violent.
I think, in a fit of rage, maybe he can kind of get the jump on her, kind of overpower her. Yeah, maybe.
Turn her on.
Yeah.
Probably.
Well, we do this a decent amount in the Infinity Gauntlet, but I think it's a matter of looking at winning the battle versus winning the war.
Sure.
Because I do think that Poison Ivy could win the battle, but Groot's just going to keep coming back.
I think if she had, you know, if it wasn't in a room and she had control over other plant life...
I don't even think then. I would. My vote's going for Groot.
Gotcha.
I kind of like his version where she would nub him down to like an itty bitty splinter and then trap him into a little pendant and wear him.
But he would just grow out of it.
No, but I mean like she would create. Like,
but I don't know.
Thing.
If she can control Groot, she can control his growth as well.
Yeah, maybe like her will is just keeps him.
Then he would be baby Groot forever.
Be baby Groot
forever. That's what she wants. She saw Guardians of the Galaxy and she's like, I need it. I need it all the time.
And you keep dancing, monkey.
Asteroid Man, that's a good question.
What was that?
He says, does Poison Ivy actually control plants? Or does she just ask them to do things for her?
And she has a relationship with them.
Kind of like Aquaman doesn't actually command fish. He just convinces. Yeah. He's just like, hey, you got to do this? And they're like, sure, why not?
We're fish. We got nothing going
has
on.
Has a dolphin ever just said, no.
Well,
not
going to
do that,
if you
Aquaman.
Notice, the dolphins aren't really his thing. Like, dolphins don't really help him all that much.
Because they're mammals.
Because they're actually really intelligent and know that they don't have to listen to this dude.
Right.
Sharks, on the other hand.
Oh, yeah.
Dumb. All right, well, gentlemen, where are your votes falling?
I mean, I'd probably go with Groot, honestly. Like, I think, for one, Poison Ivy wouldn't want to kill Groot.
Right.
And if Groot had the reason to, he would absolutely rip her apart. If she killed Rocket for some reason?
Sure. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Groot would go...
That might do it.
Bananas.
Ballistic.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I'd give it to Groot because he's a powerhouse, one hit at Poison Ivy. She's down.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Down for the count.
So we tied it up with six of us here. We're just going to say that Groot and Poison Ivy live happily ever after.
Yeah. Formidable.
We made a love connection, guys.
We tried.
I like that Kirigori was asking, like, could he just leave a piece of himself somewhere in case he dies so it leaves it dormant until he
needs
it?
I've wondered if that, like a Groot
Horcrux. Exactly.
Yeah, I've thought about that.
A reserve... body part.
I should have done that.
That's a good idea.
I'm all done now with the thing.
I'm all done.
Well, you know, when we get into volume two.
Yeah. I was going to say, I was, this is like almost a deleted scene. There's like a big fight in Groot 5, like on board this ship. I was going to do like multiple Groots. Like he like grows a lot of himself, but I wasn't sure if that would work. Of like multiple man kind
of thing. Is there a story like a Marvel?
And I'm like, I don't know if that actually makes sense because it's like one consciousness or is that so?
Is there a Marvel vault that you can go to that has all the answers to these kind of things, or you just make your own mythology?
With Groot, who's kind of newer onto the scene from like the movie exposure, you can kind of play around a little bit. Mm-hmm. They're tighter about like Spider-Man and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. Obviously,
I thought about it, but I just did. I went a different route with like kind of a big Groot action moment, but I thought about that for a long time.
Because then you could own that. Like, if they bring it back in, like, Guardians of the Galaxy 2, and he, like, splinters off and makes an army of Groot. That's
because
of you.
I should have.
That's a good call.
Well,
let's
here
get
we go.
Bishop, take you back in time. For the future!
So, like, three minutes on the clock.
Let's close it out with let's do two good questions
for Jeff. Yeah, good questions for Jeff.
Anything that you guys have been waiting to ask all show long?
Well, and Neo, if you could change to the Watchtower.
When's Groot number 5 coming?
Groot number 5 should be out, it's usually the first Wednesday of the month, so it'll be October.
Cool.
And then it'll end in November, last one. So it's a 6-issue kind of limited series run. It's cool. Like, you got to do, like, a beginning, a middle, and an end, which is kind of rare for comic book runs, right? Mm-hmm. It's always, like, this extended second act, and it, like, never quite ends because it always leads to something.
Is there a Secret Wars incursion ending?
No Secret Wars. So, it's, like, its own thing. Cool. Actually, I would say, like, it all takes place in the old Marvel Universe, and so in a way, we're telling almost the last, like, 616 story. It felt kind of weird. Like, issue 6, not to give too many spoilers, it's like this road trip through the Marvel Universe. And as I was writing it, I'm like, oh, wow, by the time this comes out, like, this won't exist anymore. Yep. It's like this last, like, postcard from the Marvel we all know.
That's awesome.
Ooh, that's a great question.
Really good question. Your Real Uriel is asking you, what would Groot do if he put on the Infinity Gauntlet?
Ooh, man. Does the Infinity Gauntlet warp you at all in your mind, or are you still just your most heightened self and so much power?
We're not the Marvel writers.
I don't think it.
I'd say, you know, Groot does not lust after power, nor gold, nor death.
But if he did?
If he did, I think he would try to give everyone a moment of tranquility and peace, and everyone could feel as Groot does, which is nothing but benevolence and kindness towards his fellow people.
And then they say, hashtag we are Groots.
We are Groot. He would give everyone a we are Groot moment. He would like raise it up, and everyone would say we are Groot, and they would just feel that transcendence.
That's adorable.
Building off that, Asteroid Man has a burning question. Will you promise to have a good night and take care of yourself?
No.
There you go.
Asteroid
the world
Man,
is
no
full
promises.
Of darkness.
No well-being for you.
Wow. No, I'm just going to spiral into the abyss tonight.
No Daystar.
Awesome.
All right, well, 1 minute. We'll just do the outro, and let's definitely thank Jeff as well.
Yeah, thank you, Jeff.
Well, with 35 seconds. Guys, you've been watching Twin Galaxies Live's The Comic Book Show. We're here every Wednesday night from 9 to 11 Pacific time. Be sure to follow us on Facebook and Twitter. Tweet at us and let us know what you think.
And
also, catch our bite-sized episodes on YouTube every Monday on Stan Lee's World of Heroes. Ooh. Jeff, thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah.
For
sure.
It was so much fun.
Thank you. Thank you guys so much.
Guys, be sure to follow Jeff on Twitter as well, and pick up all of the Groot books that are out now, including Groot 5 is coming up, and Groot 6 will be out in about a month. Take it easy.
Bye.
Thanks, guys. See ya.
Twin Galaxies.